Hey guys, I'm Chris from The Blazing Show with Chris, and I'm here with Peter Klein.
Chris!
Peter, you there?
Yeah! Sorry, I was a little late just now.
Oh, it's alright. I thought you weren't there, like, you were something about business and then you were coming back.
Oh yeah, well I mean I was gonna do some business, take care of some things, and then head back, and I did some of that, and then I got started just doing some very basic cleaning up on the garden on the patio, and it was just, God, I lost track of time, you know. It seemed like it was just, normally if I'm doing that stuff, it doesn't go by so quick. So, anyway, so you want me to get on a better microphone? I probably should. Let me get my microphone. That's,
yeah, while you do that, in case you don't, guys don't know, Peter Klein, he's one of the creators of the movie or documentary, We Need to Talk About Sandy Hook.
That's right, absolutely. We'll get into that, hopefully.
Yes.
Right. Hopefully or otherwise. I'm kind of burned out on the topic of Sandy Hook in particular. Not that I am too burned out to actually, you know, talk about it or make some progress on it. But in general, the material I've been talking about lately, Sandy Hook, the specifics, you know, the details, it's not very often I get into that. Although I do still, and I know some people who have questions, you know, just like one or two real specific questions. They really want to know some things. All right, hold on a second. Let me get a new microphone in here and see if this helps a little bit. Actually, I'm gonna use the same mic. I'm gonna switch to a headset. That'll help. Hold on just a second here.
All right.
All right, let me confirm that you're still there.
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay, I turned you up pretty good. Now, let me see. Hold on one second. Let me switch over. Okay, you should not be hearing any more feedback. Does that sound any better?
Yeah, perfect.
Okay.
Okay, well, great. Before you get to the documentary, can you talk a little about yourself?
Sure. My name is Peter Klein, and I am originally from California, actually, the Bay Area of California. I was born in 68, but really late in the year, but I was still pretty much a child of the 60s, you know, the Love Generation and all that. In fact, for a time, I lived in an old Victorian house with my mother and father, and the remaining members of my dad's band, like maybe 9 or 10 other people, in his band called the Blondes. And, you know, like blonde hair, the Blondes. So that's kind of what my upbringing was. It was not traditional in any way. So in a way, that may have been part of the reason why I was more, I guess, either suggestible or inclined to look into alternative answers to, you know, either problems or scenarios in history itself when things didn't add up, when I was looking at it from the, you know, the official storyline. So anyway, that's where I was born and raised in the Bay Area of California. I got involved. I had a lot of jobs in my lifetime. You know, at one point, I think I wrote down, I itemized it, and I was counting just jobs, and I had reached 30, and that's a lot of jobs.
30.
I left some off the list because they just weren't, you know, like I used to go door to door for a guy named Dan the Rapper. I was only like 11 years old, but I mean, I would literally draw a paycheck from this guy. I didn't count that job. You know, I still had 30, so I've been doing a lot of stuff, but that was mostly in the earlier years. Then I kind of gravitated towards sales and marketing, and through that, I got interested in the internet. And that was convenient, considering what I'm doing now, because that was a great jumping off point. I did it in reverse. Normally, people would go from, you know, being a techie to getting into the sales and marketing angle of it, but instead I was in sales and marketing and support, and I had interest in what was actually going on the internet, you know, the actual, you know, the the zeros and ones, the bits and bytes, and all that, and the applications. So I got into that. And that got me interested in, to a small degree, in blogging and in, it was my first experience with some alternative news sites that were, you know, very, very few in the early stages of the internet, but that was very instrumental, though. It was just kind of, all these things are tiny coincidences that really, in the end, added up to me being where I'm at now, which, you know, it's very hard to imagine getting to the place I'm at, because for so many years in my, you know, you're asking to talk about myself. Well, myself, that guy, he was a real idiot. He didn't know very much. And I mean, I'm, of course, referring to myself, but it was just like a different person compared to who I am now, because I had zero interest in history and zero interest in really government affairs or politics. I didn't understand what those things were fundamentally. You know, I thought I did, but obviously it was like an illusion that was somehow very easy to impose, put upon me, or I did it to myself, either way. So I was wrong about that, and I had to go back and reevaluate things. So anyway, that's, for the most part, my story, although there's lots of other stuff in there, too.
By the way, talk about the documentary. We need to talk about Sandy Hook. How'd that come about?
Well, yeah. See, this is the thing. What I did early on the internet was I worked actually in sales and marketing for internet companies when they were brand new. Most of these companies people had never heard of. I don't know if you were around or if you remember any of these companies, like big ones like UUNet would be one, you know, big one. But there was BBN, Planet, and PSI. Remember those companies?
The only stuff I heard of is America Online.
So America Online was one of those early companies, but they had one customer segment, and that was consumers, you know, the regular end users, the people like you and me, college students and grandparents and people who work from home and anybody who wanted access to the internet and was willing to pay through the nose to get, you know, very little. You remember how little internet we used to get. It was so painful. You used to get all those America Online discs in the mail, you know. Damn. People have collections of those things. It's just outlandish. I don't know what the deal was.
Now you could probably put them like into disco balls. If you like put all this, like cut them off. This is on the... you could put a bunch of discs and then like... cut them all into tiny little pieces and then put them on a styrofoam ball and make a disco ball. It's neat.
You could, or you could do, yeah, there's, maybe you could do some art piece out of it. I'm sure someone has. I never thought about doing it, but it's a good idea, though. Make a disco art ball. See how many you could make. Probably can make one for every man, woman, and child on the planet. That's too many, man. But anyway, that's who you knew about, and most people did, America Online. But behind the scenes, somebody was making the internet like broader and connecting it together with more businesses, you know, because now think about where we're at. I'm sure today, like if you have internet access where you're at, it's probably with a media company like a Comcast or a Time Warner. And, you know, those companies had nothing to do with the internet at all in the earliest days. So they were basically just completely unaware or really like just putting it off for as long as they could, while other companies said, you know what, I'm going to get in there and start doing it. And so these early companies provided internet access to businesses at very high costs. You know, instead of a bunch of people paying a monthly fee for, 20 to 50 bucks a month for internet access so many hours at 56K modem speed, there would be, let's say, a 256K dedicated in, or maybe a bridged ISDN situation where you have two 128K ISDN lines connected together to make 256K of throughput. And then that would go in to a network at a business. And let's say the network had, you know, 100 PCs on it and they were being used. That was still not much internet to share. But when you're all kind of not doing it at the same exact moment, and you're not doing big file downloads, it really improves the internet speed. You know, when you go to download your email, let's say, and it has some attachments, you know, back then, if everyone did it at the same time, it would take a long time, it would slow down. But this was, you know, much better. It was always on, no modem, no, you know, dialing in. But it was real expensive. It could be $1,000 or $2,000 a month for something like that back then for businesses per month. It was amazing. You know, and I got involved in selling some of these connections to people. So I would sell to a business a contract term for, let's say, a year or two of monthly internet access at a T1 speed, which is just 1.5 megabit per second of throughput. And that would cost sometimes, you know, on the low end, it might be $700 complete per month. On the high end, it might be as much as $3,000 a month for that thing. And they would pay for it. So they needed the internet real bad. Back in the earliest days, it was not a lot of fun. It was more of a pain. It was like a chore. Because if you needed to get on there, you probably needed it for some functional reason. Or maybe you were already being outcompeted. What was that?
It was hard to come by.
Well, yeah, I mean, there was that too, and not everyone could even get it because, you know, they didn't have all the network they have today. So, like, in a small business park, they may have everybody in there doing just fine, and everyone's got phone systems and PBXs and stuff, but then somebody decides, you know, hey, I want to get a T1 internet in here, and they go, okay, well, we'll get a price quote for you, and the phone company locally, they're part of that charge. It's actually two costs. The cost to the internet company, the internet provider, who provides you the bandwidth, but there has to be a pipe. The phone company has to provision a wire just for you guys. And so that's their cost, and that's a monthly too. So, you know, the two costs come together. But the phone company would get back to us sometimes and say, nah, can't do it. We're all used up. The demarcation of the building is full. You know, all the wires, all the capacity there is all being used in telecommunication and maybe some internet, but there's no more room to put a full T1. And then they'll say, well, or if you want, I could quote you for us installing a new one. And they'd be like, okay, that's going to be $20,000. Because sometimes it would mean they'd have to, like, dig a trench across the road or something, you know. And we'd sometimes tell the person, yeah, you could pay $20,000 and have them dig the trench. And they usually would say, forget that. And try, I think, you know, they'd try to do something else. It would usually just be a big problem for some people. They literally couldn't even get it in their, wherever their business may have been. And other people are more lucky, you know, they might be right where they need to be. But, so I got into the back end, you know, the pipes of the internet, in a business way, and saw how that grew, and I went through all of the technology in that from 93 through to, you know, well, through the development of of DSL, right, and the various types of DSL. I did all that, and along the way, and of course, the internet's, the web content really exploded, you know, online banking and all the other things. There was no social media to begin with. There was nothing. And then finally, these social media sites picked up and kind of really took off pretty fast. And it's just going gangbusters now. But at some point in time, I got really tired of really the sales and marketing side of it. A lot of the people I worked with some of the accounts I might, you know, support. These are big phone companies, companies like USN Communication in Chicago. They actually moved me there 1 year. I moved to Chicago to manage the account for a client, and I actually had an office in their building. And so I would go to work for a company called USN for over a year, and yet I didn't work for them. I worked for another internet company that was their provider, their like partner to, you know, help them learn and start adopting the internet. But These guys were a phone company, and phone companies are real aggressive. They're real cutthroat sales forces. It's not something I'm a big fan of, so it got kind of stressful, and eventually I saw the light when I got interested in the content on the internet and all the, you know, HTML and all that stuff. And so that's where I started making the move away from the back end to the front end, you know, the applications instead of the pipeline. Now the pipeline, you know, we're so far down the road now, I don't even know barely anything about the modern day internet and the way it works. I used to know almost exactly how the internet used to work in the early days because, and I'm pretty close, I guess I could probably take a stab at it and guess what it's like today. But I used to actually be told, you know, hey, Peter, while you're in Atlanta, can you go over here? And I would go to a telephone company's, you know, offices, their central offices. And we would have, you know, as an internet company, we would have leased part of us of their, you know, their switching room where they would be connecting and, you know, doing all of their switching as a phone company. And we would also be there, and but we would be there as part of our network for, you know, for as an internet provider. So we would have like a big giant Cisco 7500 router. Massive routers, you know, these things were. And they would tell me, can you please, you know, we need you to connect to this router and run some tests and things. And so I would literally be doing some of the internet backbone management, you know, maintenance remotely with our network guys. But I would get to see a lot. I learned a lot in that process, and I got to see a lot of the the phone companies and stuff. I used to be able to go walk right into the phone company's computer, you know, their switching room right just next to the offices I had actually in when I was first in Kentucky in Lexington. It was there where actually I was able to do that with a competitive local carrier where they had a massive room, and I would just go right on in. It was a little bit crazy. There was not much security and stuff. This is before 9/11 at that point. But anyway, so how I got to that from that point on, well, you know, really, I would say, you know, I think there was a big, you know, 9/11 did a lot for me. It did not really wake me up in itself. I didn't really get it. I knew it was something was wrong about it, but, you know, I'd seen Oklahoma City, and I thought, that's weird. I remembered that. I thought, they just said there was bombs being taken out of the building. I saw one, and they said, there it is, and it was on it had a blue tarp over it, and a lot of things were said about bombs and about, you know, back up, we got another bomb scare. They're confirmed. They're trying to dismantle or disable the bomb. What's that?
You talk about the Oklahoma City, the bombing. Yeah. The Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms Bureau, ATF, and probably the Justice Department had that.
Yeah, well, I know they probably saw
the people making the bombs, planting the bombs.
But
who's in trouble? No one. Not like they only put a penalty on trouble, but like the rest of them are still out there. But what about?
Yeah, well, they used to have the. Remember, they had the number two guy. They were looking for the John Doe number two, and then they just said, oh, "I guess there never was one," and just gave up. But yeah. Well, you know what? You should know this. If you don't, if your audience doesn't, they need to know that you mentioned the Department of Justice, and I just want to say, boy, oh boy, it's no coincidence that old Holder is in office right now because he was very instrumental in the Oklahoma City deal. He was actually part of the cleanup operation, at least politically and in the minds of the press and the citizens, because he in particular, there was an incident that went down where a guy was killed because the local cops thought he was supposedly John Doe number two, and they actually were upset about, they were totally off base about who did the bombing and all of it, but you know, they felt upset enough to beat up a guy. And they beat him up so much that he wound up dying in his jail cell. and they tried to clean the whole thing up. Well, his brother just so happened to be a very skilled lawyer, and he found out what was up, and he said, you know what? He called down there, and he said, look, you guys, first, number one, no cremation. Hold that body. And then by the time he got down there, boom, they had already cremated him, and nobody would admit who had approved it. And then they did some testing. This guy said, let me test that cell, and he did. And the whole cell, you know, the walls, the ceiling, was just massively coated with blood stain that had been masked over. You know, it had been bleached and cleaned up. But when you use the special, you know, the infrared or whatever they're using, the light sources that can show that stuff, he said it was real easy to tell at that point. It was all over. The whole place was glowing. And then he pointed out also that, you know, there was a lot of cover-up aspects to it. But it was Holder who, over the years, even to this day, this lawyer still has legal battles with the Department of Justice and Eric Holder over this very issue of the Oklahoma City bombing.
He gets away with everything. And it was this video, we must brainwash people about guns.
I've also asked the school board to make a part of every day some kind of anti-violence, anti-gun
message. That's brainwashing
message.
Guns.
Every day, every school, at every level. One thing that I think is clear with young people and with adults as well is that we just have to be repetitive about this. It's not enough to simply have a catchy ad on a Monday and then only do it every Monday. We need to do this every day of the week and just really brainwash people into thinking about guns in a vastly different way.
Get the...
Yeah, I'm familiar with that, and I gotta say, I'll tell you one thing. He is really—he very much reminds me of like a here's an adult, intelligent man, and it's like he's playing the game, like he's playing a video game called politics or something. You know, he just has to win, and he doesn't really seems. I don't really pick up a sense that he cares what he's doing, but he's gonna be very good, and he's gonna be very slick.
What about the race politics? I heard that also comes into play, the race politics.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, I heard it too, but I don't even know why it's brought up so much.
Why is he not fired? He was supposed to be out, like, Fast and Furious. He was caught doing that, and, like, he was supposed to be out a long time ago.
Well, you know, that is true, and I do have a lot of – I'm interested in it. I can't keep up with that topic, but I am interested in what Holder's doing right now. And I remember hearing a joke – you know, not long ago, it was ran in one of these political papers that were kind of satirical, you know, joke paper stuff, like The Onion or something. But it said that he had taken a job as a senior executive at Goldman Sachs for $70 million a year or something. And everyone said, ha ha ha, that was funny. It was like a joke to them and to me too. But the back of my mind, I thought, well, wait, I don't see him denying it. And it made me wonder, I wonder if he did take that job because it's the perfect job for a guy like that to just start collecting the money for the work he's done. But maybe he didn't finish it. Maybe he's not, maybe there's something he still needs to do. You know, before he can get away clean.
This was in a bunch of articles. Eric Holder takes $77 million job with J.P. Morgan Chase.
There you go.
It was a attorney for Goldman Sachs CEO. Is Eric Holder's quote best? This was from Breitbart. Breitbart, Goldman non-persecution as Eric Holder has no balls on Rolling Stone. I'm reading it as I'm not up. I'm not up.
Well, it's supposed to be a joke, is what they started saying. And now, you know.
Goldman Sachs is a private place. Like, you can't go there unless you work.
Well, yeah, but, you know, they may have it. Well, yes and no. I mean, Goldman Sachs.
Most people go to the lobby and then they have to go.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing. And I don't know really the terms where I thought, I was just like you. I thought that Eric Holder was supposed to already be gone, like as of January at the latest or something. So maybe he is on the way out. We're just haven't seen it. But, you know, because they don't like to keep us informed. So whatever's going to happen, they'll just do it.
There was someone else taking his place. It was probably going to be much worse.
Yeah, you know, that's true. So we got to remember the battle isn't won just because some of these. Well, think about George W. Bush, how everyone was so upset about him in the end.
He left, but the agenda stays. And he's not arrested for his war crimes.
Oh, no, and he gets to hang out.
And look what happened to Malaysia. When Malaysia found him guilty, they downed 3 planes. I'm not saying that's the case, but that's probably probable.
Did that really happen? Malaysia did find him guilty of, like, a war crime or something? Was it Bush?
Yeah, Bush found guilty of war crimes.
Oh, my God, I totally didn't even know that.
It was a mock trial. Here it is. Wow. This is from expolitics.blogs.com, the Millennium Report, commondreams.com. Here's one from the Huffington Post. Former County Tesorum Tsar Richard Clark Bush Cheney committed war crimes. And then after that, like, they can't do anything. But, like, since they're not, actually, they're not working now. They're, like, they're not working anymore. They're not active. But remember the planes, the MH17, 370, Air Asia. Weren't they from Malaysia? And weren't they down?
They were. Yeah, they were.
This is Rothschild written all over it.
Well, it doesn't even matter whether Bush is in office or not, man, because listen, you know how it works. This is like imagine all these guys as having been like a group that did a bank robbery. They can't, just because one guy is hiding out and another guy is not, they're both very interested in what the other's doing. So, you know, because any one of them falls, the whole thing. Like you mentioned Richard Clark. Oh, man, that Richard Clark, he has been shaking in his boots since 9/11. That guy has been trying to pretend like he's a good guy ever since then. He is so stressed out. He looks like a coked-out man balloon of stress. And he just keeps coming close to the edge of trying to say too much and... You know, and the reason why he's so dangerous is that he seems like a nice guy. He's willing to talk with people like 9/11 truthers. And this is the worst. Well, and his story is that he was left in the dark. The CIA did not inform him about things leading up to 9/11. That's all fine and dandy. But here's the scariest part. Now, after 9/11, he was appointed to the National Security Council real fast. At a time when it was a little convenient because it was about time for him to be reviewed or vetted for a position of some kind, or they were interested in vetting him, and all they did is say, oh, I'm sorry, we just put him on the National Security Council, which means you can't learn anything about him, and we can't either. Nobody gets to know about his background now, or at least when he was in the council. I don't know if he's still on it. I doubt it, but anyway, so his involvement is deep.
But what about George Soros? Dick Cheney, Kissinger.
Oh, yeah. Oh, Kissinger, big time, yeah. Cheney, I can't say. And I know that Soros has his part, but Soros is so... He's such an international, globalist person for so long. He has very little to do with the day-to-day United States type stuff. His politics is way more global. He's already dealing... You know, in issues that are very multicultural and multinational, whereas here in the States, a lot of the stuff mostly what I focus on is
bunch of the stuff probably at the White House, Soros. So he's that powerful.
Well, that's the thing is, yeah, he does have that, and you remember now, his Soros is kind of like, like the guy Maurice. Maurice Green, is it? I forget his name. It's something like Maurice Green, but he was the...
Maurice Strong?
What's that?
Maurice Strong?
Yes, there you go. Yeah. Maurice Strong. Yeah.
He's the guy who was with the global warming crud.
Oh, yeah. And also Agenda 21. He's a UN. They're both UN people.
He's former UN.
Well, but, you know, he is that type of person who is... very much beholden to and following the UN agenda and Agenda 21. So Soros and Maurice Strong are very similar people in my mind, you know, very powerful. And they're two people that barely anyone knows. Most people don't know those guys. So they're more dangerous and they're able to come and go as they please. I know Maurice has lived in China for, at least 10 years now.
They're not indicted. You know, Kissinger got indicted in Cambodia, Bush, Switzerland, and a bunch of these people got indicted in Iceland. When are we going to start, like, indicting these people? We can't.
Well, that's the thing. Yeah, no. You know, Well, you may understand it like I do, that the only way we're going to get past any of this, unless there's just a really lucky occurrence that I can't even imagine, but we're going to have to actually do something about it. We're going to have to get, you know, like the fewer the people there are, the more outrageous the act's going to be. And that's why, unless enough people wake up, we're going to probably have a little bit of a, you know, an ugly revolution of some kind or something. And it just seems like that's about...
Like, it's like not, we're not calling for anything. It's just that it's coming down to that. What are you going to do with
it? Yeah, exactly. We won't have a choice, yeah. And that's why I say it's better to do things now and to stay active and to don't you know, take too long a break from your work, because when we're doing this now... You know, we may do something. We may have an impact, make an impact in this situation. And it's hard to predict when there'll be a breakthrough. So it's better. It's like all hands on deck. You know.
And by the way, there's a bunch of stuff that has like it's calling the shots and controlling the government and all that, including the UN. But there was also this bill in Congress that passed. It didn't pass. I doubt it did. It's H.R. 75, also known as the American Sovereign Restoration Act of 2013. It ends basically the membership of the U.S. The U.S. can get out of the U.N.
Well, but who? I wonder.
That's not
going to
happen anytime soon, is it?
You know, I tell you, that's good news in a way. I still like to hear.
My parents are like, in a way, more ignorant, but they're not the only ones, and I don't really blame them. Because they start to give me these guilt trips why should we get out of the UN, etc. You know, like the UN is in control by people who would rape and kill innocent people around the world.
People don't.
The UN doesn't do that.
Yeah, well, I would say most people from South America, anywhere in Latin America, from Asia, these are the countries where the UN is seen as like the supporters of the non-white, population. And so they kind of balance that Western power structure with the rest of the world. And the UN is always seen as, you know, we're the United Nations, like the United Colors of Benetton or something, you know?
No, United nothing, if you ask me.
Well, that's exactly right. I mean, they're a real cult-like organization of people who are bureaucrats to the core. It's almost like the UN already in our world. The UN is kind of like an Orwellian government society.
Wait till the UN troops come.
I hear you, but I still think that the troops aren't the problem. I'll tell you right now, it's always been us. It's always just been the stupid people of the world who don't know anything. They're told something and they believe it. They don't have to pick up a gun. You know, the troops don't. They don't even have to have armies anymore. So they don't need any blue helmet guys. All they're gonna do is scare us with an Ebola hoax and do that kind of stuff.
By conquest or by consent.
So the consent's what we're doing.
They don't need to like invade us here. No, they brainwash you. That's enough. Like Eric Holder. But what about like these people in South America, like Rockefeller being in a place like Chile?
Oh, it's always
do they know who he is?
No, I think I would say
gotta be told somehow. Somebody's gotta warn these people.
I'm telling you,
I'm Hispanic. I say that because I'm a human being.
These are smaller nations and they have more volatile populations because their governments have been despots and they've been crooked and they come and go. And there are lots of times there are coup type, changes in government where suddenly everybody is just flipped out. You know, we've got a whole new government comes in, new laws are in place, and then you have to live your life. So they're more at risk.
But could it be if the country is so small, that's when people are like, there's less people, and then they could find out quickly like that? You know, I was talking one day with a Horder Turfesson. That's the guy who led the Icelandic Revolution. And he said that ISIN, like, would know right there quickly if anything was wrong. Laws passed quickly. They arrested the bankers who were racing to the airport, and they mostly got away. But like three of them, they like probably grabbed the plane. He doesn't believe that, but it's probably you know, I'm going up to my plane. I'm going to my armored compound. Whoop! No, you're not. The police grabbed them out of there.
Well, that's the thing. Now Iceland is a very small population.
They're free from New World Order. I gotta envy them. They had their 1776.
Oh yeah. Well, we don't even know
Obama
in America.
Obama sold power when they're free.
We don't even get to know what happened in Iceland and America.
Now you do.
Well, I know. You say, I get it. I mean, I know kind of roughly. But, you know, they used to tell the details of these things in America.
Of course,
you know,
news was back then.
That's big time.
News was new. They would put the Vietnam War on TV. Now they don't do that anymore.
Yeah, that's right. Well,
to the sensitivity of people?
No. It's because, listen, think about it. Why didn't they put Iceland on there? Because that was a victory story for the people.
Yeah, I know, but like I'm saying, like Vietnam. Why wouldn't they put Vietnam? Like, why don't they put the war in Iraq, Afghanistan, just like they put Vietnam on TV at one point?
Well, because you know what? Here's most of the reason, and I've done enough work into this. I know a lot of the details. It's because they're just idiots. They didn't do it right. They put all their eggs in one basket with this whole this media center thing, and everything would come from there. And, you know, in both Afghanistan and Iraq, they had embedded media, and some of it was so strict that really these guys all had where you associate with your captors. Oh, it's a syndrome.
Stockholm syndrome.
Thank you. So they all had that, and so they couldn't even, you know, report the news without bringing themselves and emotions into it. And then when they did report it at all, it pretty much never made it to TV here. It might have been taken as some talking points, or if it was exciting enough, you know. And then they sexed it up with some video editing and stuff. But they didn't have to cover the real war. Because they already had the media
capable of generating something. You know, Dick Cheney probably got billions from the war, and people who tried to expose that were in jail and are probably still in jail now. And he's been in jail.
Yeah.
And people, and I talk to people, maybe they're ignorant, but like, oh, what did he do? Dick Cheney, he didn't do anything. Prove it. And then like they just call it BS. I'm like, you gotta be freaking kidding me.
Oh, well,
that's the people I would talk to, you know.
That's the Stockholm syndrome. Sounds like your friends and your family and your neighbors, they have Stockholm syndrome too.
Why do you say that?
Well, because that's what it's like. When people are telling you, Dick Cheney, you don't have any proof.
George Soros, you know, he paid millions, and it's not even classified. You can find articles. George Soros brags about Ukraine, funded the Ferguson riots. Come on.
Oh, yeah. You can actually sit down and draw out an exact detailed account of how the crimes operate and how the conspiracy to uphold the power structure is in place and how it works every day. You can easily do that. But who has the patience to listen to you or to even look
very
at
few people,
it because they don't understand it?
Very few people, and it's like the cognitive dissonance people have. If it threatens their belief, that they don't believe it. It's like people are programmed by robots, like robots. You know, they're here. You're gonna believe this. You're gonna believe that. Boom.
Yeah. Nah. Well, that's why it's important, I think, now to find. It's not easy to do, but anytime you can tailor your message so that it demonstrates that this affects you. You know, really show them how, look, here's a problem, and make it as simple to understand. They'll get it eventually, you know? It just takes time.
Yeah, but most people are like, enjoy yourself. You got to enjoy your life as much as you can.
They're trying to be nice. They're trying to do the nice thing and help you out. They don't want you to be too stressed out, man.
Yeah.
They don't understand that it's the other way around.
They don't understand
you know?
The world is being freaking social engineered.
Yeah, and they think that it's like,
like saying the colonists should have never fought the Brits.
They think of it as a viewpoint. That if you just change your viewpoint, that like the bullet will go right through you, or I don't know, but They just don't get it because they don't really get it. You know, I remember my dad yelled at me for one of the worst times as an adult male, which didn't make any sense. And it was because I was talking about, I started talking about Jews and what they've been doing in various, you know, aspects of society in different nations.
People say it's the Jews, recently. But no, I've talked to people. I even have Rabbi Weiss on. And he's Jewish man through and through, and he does not like Israel.
Well, and the point is, there you go. There's a lot of them. Not every rabbi is pro-Israel. We know that.
He's an awesome Jew, though. Dude, he doesn't want war. He wants basic freedoms. He doesn't want Israel controlling everything. He doesn't like Israel that exists in the first place.
Well, but so my point is that my dad, he didn't think he had enough information about the way things are politically for him to actually get into any kind of a debate or serious conversation with me on at this point in time, you know, a couple of years ago. However, when he heard me say something negative about Jews, he jumped down my throat and told me he would not hear it in his house and all this stuff. Wait, and I thought to myself, well, there you go.
Wait, it's another example.
Well, no, but I mean, we have Jews in the family. My name is Klein, and we have fairly prominent Jews. And we're actually getting older and dying off, you know. But some of the family some of the offspring remain Jewish, but nothing at all like it used to be. But it doesn't matter. And they were very non-aligned Jews. They don't really care about either the race or the political or the Zionist element. They care mostly that they themselves and the family are happy, and that's about it. They're really lightweight Jews, you know. But here's the thing. But my point with my dad is that, hey, see, he didn't even have any of the information to really talk to me about stuff. But he was still so propagandized that he was able to at least claim to know enough to support Jews. And I thought to myself, well, that's great, but it's too bad that you picked the wrong thing to put your foot down about and to insist.
You should put your foot down if what the Federal Reserve is doing, what the FDA is doing, CDC is doing. Yeah, that's where you get really angry. Don't get angry at me telling you. I don't. Does it look like I work for the FDA? No. I'm just a messenger.
And you can't even tell anyway. It's like it doesn't even matter. Proof is in the actions. You know, it's like when you spend some time getting to know someone, if they're a good person, it begins to show real easily. It doesn't take too long, you know. And if they don't happen to commit any atrocities along the way, it's just all the better, you know. But then there are people, and whether they be Jewish or part of some other kind of criminal,
what they are,
you know, element. Exactly. And even when they say they're Jewish, if you ask them, I still can't get a straight answer. They claim one thing, they mean another. Sometimes they have no claim and they just speak from ignorance and they admit it. Other times they say up and down, I am a Khazarian. And other times they say, you're out of your mind. They call you an idiot.
You know,
they don't even know themselves. And I think when they do know what they think they know, if they're close to accurate there, that's fine. But the bottom line is that whoever you are, if you're committing crimes or if you're being deceptive, and being deceptive in an organized way to a community, to like bilk a community out of income so that you can survive as a ethnicity or race, or religion, and it's all on the backs of your neighbors and stuff. Those are Jews to have a weird thing with karma. It's like they have their own version of it, and it doesn't have any bad, there are no repercussions for if you're Jewish. It's like karma works with Jews, but it just doesn't matter, though, if you do something bad to a non-Jew.
And it's so weird. The word is goyim. It's a Jewish word for it means someone's not Jewish.
Well, and that also means that if they're using terminology like that to this day, it's an absolute racist or national, or at least ethnically superior standpoint. And it's not right in America that we have this, duality politics where, you know, hey, you cannot say anything bad or even question the Jewish faith and concepts and the politics even of Jews or even Israel. But you can do it, you know, left and right if you're Jewish to the rest of the world. See what I mean?
Yeah.
If you're a Goyim. You know?
But in any way, if you try to do a discussion, isn't like, what do people take as true? Whenever you're saying that something and you're proving it, they say it's just BS. That's kind of dissonance. I really hate that. Getting really sick of that. By the way, can you get into the movie, we need to talk about Sandy Hook?
Yes. Yeah, I'm going to just go right to it so I don't get sidetracked anymore. I know I took us way off track on that.
That's all right.
Well, the point is that, you know, there is a lot of my life going on between the time when I first started, you know, just getting interested in politics and in, you know, things like, oh, false flag terrorism and that kind of stuff. Well, between that and this documentary and where we're at now today, well, at some point in time, I started blogging. And I had a blog, I still do, it's called, you can find it at tyrannynews.com. So it's a pretty good domain. I thought it was a good concept. It was me writing articles, mostly, about various issues, not always conspiracy stuff. A lot of it was straight politics, stuff that was historical, interest stuff. But mostly, it was all conspiracy. 9/11, you know, all of that was most interesting. The moon landings, even. That stuff was very interesting to me because I started to see it just like a snowball. I'd never seen it before. I never really
understood. Yeah, the snowball going down the hill, you know.
Yes, exactly. And it was not good. It looked like all these things. I kept thinking, when is it going to end? When am I going to be able to say gravity is, you know, when I wake up, I can put my feet on the ground and it will, you know, if that's going to change at some point, just because I realized I was being tricked, you know, I just really want the world not to change so dramatically just based on a revelation in my own mind. You know, it makes it very unstable, a world to live in when things aren't what they say.
It goes to like where point, like that's a snowball, you know, the snowball effect is snowball effect. It starts as a little thing, goes down the hill, gets bigger. There's no turning point. You can't go back, and then it gets bigger, and then bam.
Yeah, true. Luckily, I don't think I've ever learned any. Well, I don't think I have yet come across anything that I've learned that I wish I hadn't learned. You know, it's like there is a potential, and I may have. I may have just blocked it out or something, but
I don't. When I first started asking you, like, about the, we need to talk about Sandy Hook, there was, like, some kind of freaking bug on the site. You know, the page was, like, it would not submit. I've told you this before off air.
Yeah.
Yeah, and the phone was reloading. I can't get in the contact page. Then you managed the site, so I don't know what happened. Was it a bug or something?
Well, I don't know the answer to that. And even to this day, I haven't been able to really take the time to sit down and run, have a system in place to do regular checks and to also verify, you know, on every different type of browser and every type of mobile device, if everything is going to work correctly and everything is, compatible and compliant. So I don't know for sure what's going on even right now. I'm trying my best. I think it's going to work for most people. You know, the site should be fine for the most part. And when people have problems, I encourage them to find the email address there to the IMS group, which is probably just staff@mediasolidarity.com. That would be one, you know, but it'll be there on the site. And just use your mail application, your email app, and just send us a message saying, hey, guess what? Your site isn't working for me. And if you do, make sure to do us a favor and send that.
I was one of the only ones who told you this.
Well, I'm not the only one that's had conversations about this or dealt with this, but I've only had you and maybe a couple other people reference issues. But this hasn't been that long. It's only been out for a short time still, but I was just going to say that if you do contact about a glitch, please tell us what kind of device you're on, and if you happen to feel like you'd like to show you know, give us like the version of your Android operating system.
Yeah, but that shouldn't matter. It's like helpful. The point is that there's a bug and keeps reloading every time you go on the mobile.
I'm just saying, when there's other, hey, let me tell you, it's just as bad sometimes if it's just a problem with your code and it won't let you do something like you had. It's the same thing though, you know. But yeah, it's worse when you don't know why it is and it may be done to try to kind of to screw with your operation and to intimidate you and that kind of stuff. We've had some of that. Let me explain about that stuff. Okay, so we get together as a group of YouTube conspiracy theorists, all right? I would say that's a good, you know, we had a group, a private group on Google Plus that was very, you know, we were friendly to each other, but it was a lot of people who had just come together really because of the topic of Sandy Hook in this case. There had been other groups, and there still are, about Boston and other events. But the Sandy Hook one seemed to come together and was pretty strong. And maybe in that group there were 50 individuals. So that's where it started. And then that conversation turned to, hey, let's try to put a documentary together with all of our work. You know, like we'll have each of us do a short segment on whatever we want to cover that we think we can do a good job on. And then if everyone else agrees, that's great. And we'll all do this. And in the end, we'll just put them together into one documentary that will really have a lot of, have a greater impact. Because there hadn't been a whole lot of good stuff on Sandy Hook done. Usually there isn't a whole lot. You know, we had some of the mainstream stuff. PBS did Raising Adam Lanza, which is just awful. But the quality of it and the access to material is superb because they have, you know, it's the state. They go right in and they work right with the perpetrators directly. I don't mean to be so, that's really conspiracy talk right there, but that's what happens. So PBS got a really good documentary put together. It's mostly lies, unfortunately. But that's it. You know, that's what we're dealing with.
What is this about? I was on the site and Tyranny News Network, Sandy Hook documentary phenomenon isn't about Sandy Hook. What?
Well, what I'm saying is in there, I say the real story when we launched it was not about the content of the documentary. It was about what happened when we launched that documentary. So it could have been about something else, you know, but it was obviously Sandy Hook is an important enough issue and the right people who were concerned, you know, took actions and things. But the point of that article was to really show that this is not common. You know, most people, even in the conspiracy, you know, and on YouTube world, they can launch a documentary and spend a lot of time. And I've done these before and we'll put them online and we'll be able, people will watch them and they'll start telling us they like it or they don't, but there's nothing really too exciting about that.
The video to be taken down by Vimeo and YouTube, you know.
That's right.
Copyright claims of what?
Well, the copyright claim system that they put in place with these larger companies, it doesn't really matter what the content is. If you just make a complaint, that's enough. You know, it will at least pull down your material, get your video offline, so you can't do anything to stop that from happening. If they want to take your video down, someone can file a copyright claim. It does not have to be accurate in any way, and it doesn't really even have to have the few pieces they even ask for to verify who you are and all this. It doesn't even really need all of that. And they'll take it down, you know, to be safe at least. But the thing is, that's the point at which the clocks is supposed to start ticking. And you're supposed to, with YouTube, they take your video down. If you file a counterclaim, let's say it was someone like, you know, Captain Crunch filed a claim saying that you stole his brain or something, right? So obviously it's not true, it's just a joke or something. Well, you would obviously then go and immediately file a counterclaim with YouTube.
It's so complicated. Eventually, then you could actually get involved legally, and then it's a waste of time. You have to go to court.
Well, you wouldn't do that, though. You know, like, there would be no reason for the person, if, let's say, the person playing the joke, you know, Captain Crunch and all that, they wouldn't take it the next step. After that counterclaim is filed, if they don't take action in a live court of law at that point, then YouTube says after the time ticks, you know, after the countdown is over, boom, your video goes back online like nothing happened. So, and that's what happened to a lot of our videos. It happened, you know, or, you know, the people who had uploaded it to support us and stuff. A lot of people who did that got their videos back. I did it.
People compare our main channel. People compare it to denying the Holocaust. What?
Well, I don't know. Oh, is that happened. What they say?
Sandy Hook didn't. It's a something about a capstone exercise. Yeah, I got it's on the FEMA.com. I am not joking. I talked to a few people. FEMA, National Exercise Program. This is on FEMA.gov. I'll read a little bit. The National Preparedness Goal, NPG, calls for a secure and resilient nation with the capabilities required to across the whole community to prevent, protect against, mitigate, and respond to and recover from the threats and hazards. They always put this damn language. FEMA.gov. Alaska Shield, Arden Sentry. It's not classified. It's on their site.
Yeah, the actual...
People probably signed a waiver for me. Hey, keep your mouth shut. We'll pay you a lot of money. And they did that. And they're not. That's why they won't talk.
Well, there's that. But another possibility, Chris, is that the operation they're doing this as part of is longer and broader, and they're not done yet. You know, there's that too. I've heard of that. It doesn't. It makes sense to me. And another thing is, remember, the what we see, you know, you and I, we focus on things like this because we happen to come across it or it's our background. The people who are involved in these operations who are being, you know, let's say they're being deceptive and that whatever they said is not true, let's say, and as a group they're involved in some kind of, you know, deceptive action. You know, these people, they may not, like right now, or after Sandy Hook, as time has moved on, they don't hear a lot of our complaints and a lot of our accusations. YouTube, for instance, is probably one of the few places where they can get video material that talks specifically about this. And outside of that, there's still some stuff, but it's going to be very hard to imagine that they get as much as we do.
You know, they're suing the Bushmaster. They're going to lose in court. Yeah. You're just giving yourself away. It's blowing your cover, man. Stop. Before you continue, can you talk about William Brandon Shanley?
Yeah. You know, it was a couple of years ago. We have a mutual, well, we're not friends, let's say. Shanley wasn't friends with Sophia, but I'm friends with Sophia Smallstorm.
She has her own way of telling Sandy Hook, but she knows James H. Fetzer, and she believes he's gonna be better.
Well, so, she doesn't. She's kind of, you know, reluctant. She has her quirks. She knows Fetzer, and they're, you know, associated in a sense because they've occasionally had some interactions, and I know they were. They both together were amongst a large number of, well, it wasn't too big. It was a working group on Sandy Hook. So that kind of is one of the reasons why the names come together sometimes recently is because that group, the Sandy Hook research group, they had formed. It was actually because of Sophia. It was her idea, I believe. Well, so after that group was done doing its work, it then led to her writing putting together that presentation that was put up, and then I did a redo of it with her, you know, okay. And that was also a big point where people started going, who is this woman and why do we, and I see here that she has worked with Fetzer, and it was because it was very recent in that, you know, but see, like, for instance, just because you work with Fetzer, doesn't mean that she works with Gordon Duff. But as it turns out, I was talking to her a couple days ago, and she said she had finally talked to Gordon Duff for a couple hours. And I thought it was interesting because I'm sure other people probably just assumed that they were already, you know, close friends or associates and stuff. But So I'm friends with Sophia, and where was this going? I was trying to think of where I...
William Shanley.
Oh, yes. Okay. So through Sophia, I became aware of Shanley. And it was because of Shanley's, he had formed a friendship with someone who was a mutual friend in the community of 9/11 truthers or so forth. You know, and just for your information, Sophia really is famous for the documentary film that she made really on her own, and it was a really well done one called 9/11 Mysteries, and she narrates that one as well. So everybody should go watch that. It's really well done. It's all true even to this day, although she continues to work on this stuff. I'll be honest, she doesn't, she's never going to give up on it. But anyway,
before that, I was reading something about Mike Rupert, and I know they probably killed him. You know, they could just go inside your house and put a gun over your head, write a suicide note, and then they just shoot you.
People
don't believe that, so whatever, please. Well, robots. Continue talking about the movie.
This Shanley thing. You know, he was basically a mutual friend of someone's, and I'm not even clear who that was at this point. But through Sophia, then, you know, was how he would have come in contact with me. She probably asked me, "Can I give him your email address? He wants to send you, or ask you a question or something." I think that's what it was that he wanted to see if I would be interested in producing a documentary that he was working on. Now, he has done a really good documentary that was somewhat famous, and it was also it featured Martin Sheen as the commentator narrator for this production. And he had a background in print journalism and also television journalism a little bit. And all of that together, kind of through then Sophia pointing him to me, led him to send me some emails. And I eventually I talked to him for just a few minutes on the phone one time. And then I think after that we just sent a couple emails back and forth. And I don't believe I ever actually corresponded directly with him after that. Now, at some point in time, I realized in what he was talking about that, and this was before, a long time ago, I realized that I don't want to talk to this guy because he would still send some email once in a great while. And he always seemed like he was really into one particular strategy or another. And yeah, he wanted some buy-in.
You should avoid talking to someone because like you're going to regret it eventually. Because like I was listening in the Alex Jones show. You know, and he was talking about Gary Webb, and then Gary Webb wanted to do a few projects probably with him, and then he didn't have time to Gary, and he's like, okay, that I don't like this dude. Just call me whenever you're free from whatever you're doing. Call me. Like he was like, I assume he was like pissed off. So like, and then Alex is like regretting it because he should have talked to him when he had the chance, and now he's dead.
Yeah.
So don't avoid talking to someone because you never know what could happen. I wish he was alive.
Yeah. Well, yeah, that's true. I mean, it's happened many times, actually. But, you know, Gary Webb, I forgot when you said that you're talking about the real Gary Webb from Dark Alliance or whatever, when he, you know, he worked for the San Jose Mercury News back there, that guy. I forget how old Alex Jones has been involved in this stuff. So,
I'm not sure. All I know is that he's been like for 20 years on air.
Yeah. I don't assume he's a shill like everyone else does. I actually see it as a different thing. It's not... I think we owe Alex Jones some respect.
He doesn't say Zionist because obviously...
No.
He wouldn't.
Well, neither does my dad, you know.
No, but same thing is globalist. Globalist Zionist, same thing.
That's fine. If he wants to say that, it's fine. And I've recognized his use of the term globalist all the time. And I see where he misses the mark. And sometimes he does it, and it's kind of like too obvious that he's hurtling over something. He's not just falling in a trap. He's jumping over something. And we don't get to see what that something is or what it's shaped like or whatever. But I would just assume that, you know, Alex Jones got into this for the right reasons. I do not believe that he is Bill Hicks. That is a ridiculous notion to me personally. I would love to see someone give me more info.
He kind of looks like Bill Hicks, like, not to offend anyone. He kind of does. Like, I'm talking about.
That's Russ, fine, but about, listen, man. Let me tell you one thing.
I'm saying it biologically. He does. You know.
Well, I see. Yes, he does. Yes, he does. You know, I agree. However, what's the important thing, though? You know? Listen, man. Listen. What's the important thing? The easiest thing you can do is this. Number one, you can look at his height. Okay. Now, Bill Hicks is a tall motherfucker. Before he died, Alex Jones did not ever in his lifetime yet achieve that height. So he's definitely too short to be Bill Hicks. But forget all that. One last thing is this. They say Bill Hicks died of cancer. Okay? I don't know if you know this or not, but Bill Hicks kept working as a comedian.
Yeah, Bill Hicks died. Yeah, man. And well, you know.
In the end, man, when you saw he started growing a beard, you know, he had a little bit of a bummer with Letterman because Letterman cut his segment because he said an off-color joke or something. He was very mistreated by Letterman.
Yeah.
Toward the end. Yeah, plus the guy had cancer and stuff. Well, he got down to, I'm telling you, he was rail thin, okay? So when he died, Alex Jones may look like Bill Hicks did when he was healthy. But when people use their head, they can go look at Bill Hicks with cancer, with his beard and stuff, and how tall he was. And let me tell you, you're not going to be thinking Alex Jones, right?
Yeah, but it could also be a bioweapon, you know? It could also be a bioweapon, a heart attack gun.
Well, but I'm just saying, just about specifically the relationship between Jones and Hicks.
That quote is not classified either. It's declassified.
Well, That's true. And I also want to point out to people who also
went to technical services where I was in charge of finding documents that you don't find in libraries, like, you know, destroying its effectiveness. Also, I had to find one time they wanted me to find out if there was such a thing as a poison that was undetectable, especially one that seemed.
It feels good to be right, man.
Who was that again?
I'm not sure if that was Susan Lindauer.
Oh, it was Lindauer. Yeah, Lindauer. Okay. Yeah. Well, it could be. Yeah, I mean, if it wasn't, I know who this is. Yeah, very interesting stuff. Well, but anyway, so to get on to the documentary and finish how that came together. So we worked at this together for 9 months, and in the end, some of us produced more than one segment on different, you know, on more than one topic, and others just did one. And, you know, because you at least, in order to be part of this, for us to be able to say, you know, you were one of the creators, we limited it to people who provided a segment. So there were 10 of us in total that did that. So the rest of the group is support, you know, people who did support. Some of them didn't do anything. And that's fine. And it's about, you know, willingness to participate. And you put your neck out there, obviously, if you do this. There was a guy who made a video debunking one of my segments on the cash information that was put up just, I think, 2 or 3 days ago. And it was like an 18-minute or something thing. And so this isn't over, you know, the battle of the opinions and the information itself.
But there's a difference between opinion and fact. Truth is not democracy. If it didn't happen, it didn't happen. Deal with it, you know.
Well, there's that. I don't really worry about the arguments and trying to convince people so much. I'm looking at myself and thinking, how do I actually make a difference? How do I force their hand or get the people of the world to see why this is so important to them and have them decide, yeah, let's get together and let's call for this to be done. I don't want to have to do the work all by myself or with a small group, like with yourself. And it's just too much, and there's no way we're going to make it. But so we got to get better at being like mouthpieces for larger groups or providing the tools to others so that they can start doing it. And giving them the spark to do, and they got to work quick too. They don't have the time we had. They're running out of time.
I'm surprised you could actually get this documentary. Because if people in Newtown won't talk, they probably won't believe you. Because I've been told, why don't you go down to Newtown? Why don't you go down to Newtown?
Well, a lot of us did. I didn't personally. But people won't talk though.
It's called a gag order. So how can you get them to talk? How can you go out there?
Talk.
A waste of time.
You can get people to talk. I won't tell you who, and I won't tell you what they said, but some of us in our group did go to Newtown and spoke directly with people, and also did go and speak with people not from the town but related to the story, very related, who were, you know, people who were reported on or who had direct connections to that, either way, in both cases. And in all of those examples, they just told us point blank. You know, one person said they didn't think that, in one example, it was somebody saying they didn't think Adam Lanza even existed.
Wait, so okay. They told you basically we did have to sign a contract or something like that.
Well, no, they didn't say that. They didn't say anything about that. That was true. They didn't admit to being involved, A. B, they didn't admit, none of these people admitted to being involved.
Of course, they signed a contract. They have to go along with it.
But what they did do, this is important though, what they did do is they did question the official story point blank, which you would never see in the media, people saying, you won't hear a guy say on a newscast that lots of Sandy Hook residents also wonder what happened that day. They would never say that, you know. They think they want you to think everybody's on the same page. They're all grieving still. They all want our guns taken away and for school security and mental health and all. No. It's not true, though. As you can say, as I've explained, I was actually going to go to Newtown with the co-producer Stosh, 314, who was, you know, one of the contributors to this, but he was really one of the major ones.
How can you possibly find out if they're not going to say anything? There's no way to get around that. You can't smooth talk them. You know, like, what the heck is going on? I just question the truth, you know.
I have different goals. I don't really care.
That's one reason I would like Wolfgang Halbig, because Wolfgang actually lived there. He has the balls to do what he does.
That's true, and I think Wolfgang's got one good angle at this, and what he's done, you know, with the recent he has a court case.
They're not going to answer him because the town, it was all based, even the governor probably won't say anything either. They're all in that together.
I'll tell you, let me give you another example. I don't even know if I can share this. Yeah, I'm sure I can. Okay, so the other day, you know, Wolfgang will send emails and letters to people in Newtown, you know, Pat Lodra, school board people, the city council, you know, everybody who is involved in this to some extent is a potential target for one of his letters or emails. And he sent a lot of these emails. And usually they're not all that great, in my opinion, because they just, it's his right. He'll ask them, why are you denying me, or why are you ignoring my FOIA requests? I don't understand. And he just constantly harps on that and stuff, you know, that type of thing. But this last one he did was different. What he did is he picked apart the story of the kids who went and sang at the Super Bowl. The Newtown Choir, the Sandy Hook Choir, okay? Those kids, doesn't matter who they were, all right? Let's just assume that they were kids from Sandy Hook. Here's the question he had for them. And he said it was an outright failing as a human being. He said that he wanted to know how they could live with themselves and the guilt. Because they let those kids, you know, those kids were chosen, and they were selected to travel to go see the Super Bowl and to become part of it by singing at halftime at the Super Bowl.
I've heard of that.
It doesn't matter if they were the victims or if they were new kids or whatever, but they were from Sandy Hook School, okay? That's the key part. See, so it doesn't matter who they were. It doesn't really matter. And I know that, you know, QK, one of the people who did this documentary with us, he was the guy that discovered that he thinks some of the children, and I agree with him, are actually some of the victims in those photographs, except a few years older now. But it doesn't matter. The point is that Wolfgang found an opportunity when he saw this, and he was disgusted by it, to target them with some more questions. So he questioned them. He said, you sent them, you allowed them to go. They were treated to this experience. It was one of these great moments in their lives. They're mere children. It's too much responsibility to be on their head. Somebody else had to be there to oversee this and make sure that the right thing happened and they were never given credit. Not one of those children was named, and no history book will ever know who they were.
And also, what about like Social Security? You won't find anybody. Normally,
well,
you find
that's
people.
Fine. I mean, yes, but here's the thing. The point is this: if you were invited to go co-host the Academy Awards, right? And you were a child, for God, of 10 or something. Let's say you were a 10-year-old kid and you were invited to co-host with Billy Crystal, or with Justin Bieber or something, the Academy Awards ceremony. And you went and you did the whole thing, and then when it was all said and done, nobody even bothered to ask you who you were, and you didn't happen to offer your name. And so nobody asked, and nobody knows. You're just like a ghost now. They wonder themselves, the producers of the award show. You know, imagine that. It doesn't make any sense whatsoever. So in other words, what Helbig did is he proved, because of how ridiculous the notion is and how absolutely screwed
no
up it is.
There's no emotion on this, you know.
Well, they hid, no they disclosed the names of the kids on purpose. Why? Who were they protecting? What the would you do that for? Pardon my French. I hope you can believe that. The point is that these children were given this great opportunity to sing at the Super Bowl, and everyone, literally, like I think a billion people or something, you know, whatever the ratings is for the Super Bowl, it's huge. Those people watched those kids sing, and they, for the rest of time immemorial, no one's going to know who those kids were, because nobody bothered to tell us, the viewer, let's introduce them now. Billy Smith, you know, whoever they were, could we have given?
They were. They didn't even sue the school. They sued the. they sued because they weren't paid more. Give me $30,000. I'm gonna get out. You know, it's a. They bribed them to being like actors and all that.
Well, they did. Yeah, you know exactly. No, you're right about this. Yeah, and they filed the lawsuit at the end. There's a lot of things going on that I. The lawsuits, I got to tell you, they are. It's because people think they know the way the court system works in America, and in reality, almost none of us do, number one. Number two, it's now become very easy to shift some of the procedure stuff. So you could always accept a case, but when it comes down to it, if you were going to take a case through trial, at any point in time, the judge can simply take a piece of evidence, pull it right out of the court, put it in the lockbox, and say, this is sealed. Seal this for 7 years. No one will ever see that. And it's gone. And so it's actually worse in some cases if we brought a lawsuit, a real lawsuit, to court over Sandy Hook, they may take the case. If we could force, if we did the best job we could, and we forced it, we could get that far and get through the trial. At any point during that trial, if we ever came up with any damning evidence, which is probably the reason why we would even go to do it in the first place, they would just grab it and seal it. And that would be it. They'd never have to explain why.
Copy of that one in case they do seal it. Oh, no, I have an extra copy.
Well, that's the point is, well, that's not the way these are. It's like when they, you know, Sybil Edmonds, when they gagged her, she could speak. They didn't actually put a ball gag on her. She had the right to speak, and she could speak, but she was gagged in the same way that evidence would be sealed. It means you don't share it because the penalties are very stiff.
Of course.
In fact, it's like the same thing when you sign those national security
people,
contracts.
People say to leave it alone. Peter, why are you being heartless? You know, this children, man. This children, man.
Because I'm a heartless bastard, and I just want to have fun. To me, this is just a thrill ride. No, obviously you're right, yes. It's pathetic when these people... Well, sometimes it's just tiring because we know they're disinformation operatives.
It's crisis actors, man.
Yeah, they're being paid a very, you know, somewhat nominal wage to do their work. And a lot of times they're doing it as a result of a plea bargain deal they worked out where they're like an informant. You know, they're non-official, some of them even. But, you know, informants in America can commit, you know, many crimes without expecting to be, without really there being even a precedent for them to be punished for it, because they are informants. And informants can go off and do drugs, no problem. They can deal drugs, no problem. They can beat someone up, knock them unconscious, use like severe assaults on other people. Permanent damage, no problem. They can wiretap. They can kidnap. The list goes on and on of what an informant can do. And that's because the letter of the law simply allows it, because they assume there's some greater good that could be accomplished by employing an informant. Well, but at the same time, that's just a human being you're allowing to commit crimes, and sometimes it gets out of hand. And I'm just saying that the court system, if you think about that, is not so easily predicted, you know, predictable, and it's not necessarily going to do the right thing.
It's kangaroo
in the
court.
End. It's what now?
Kangaroo court.
Yeah. Excuse me. So, you know, the bottom line is we created the documentary. They tried to suppress it. It didn't work. We had, you know, something like hundreds now. And I think right now to this day, we still have a couple hundred of these.
But why don't you sell, like, DVDs of that? You know, I don't hear that in the music. The movie industry is probably not going to want to take it.
No, you know, it's funny. There's a funny story about the first time I tried to actually just inquire about just giving it, essentially just saying, look, can you just take it from us and just do something with it? Make it available to people. And we didn't want to touch it, though, as a group, our IMS group, because we, in the first place, did not want to exchange monies at all. It was too, you know, we wanted to be clear with everyone that this is costing us money. We don't want to take anyone's money or donations. We just don't want to play that game. It's so easy to get caught up in people's confusion.
People say that Wolfgang, you know, takes donations. He's a fraud. Get here, man.
Well, you know, what am I supposed to say? You know, I just chose a different. Yeah, there you go. So Wolfgang paid the price for doing that, but I figure, well, I just don't want
to
risk it.
I talked to him, like, and he said that. Yeah, well, it's not that I would spend on myself. I'm retired, but the attorneys and all this stuff is expensive, and it is. So there has to be.
Oh yeah.
You know, you have to donate.
It's incredibly expensive.
But nobody's gonna
honest.
Answer his questions. You know, about the Sandy Hook, the porta potty.
Well, no, he's got results from the monies he spent. It takes money to play, and in other words, you know, to play means carrying this forward. So this is what he's taken a couple stabs at various court and procedural you know efforts that required money because of legal costs. He's got a lawyer in there now in multiple cases. I believe it's multiple in response to or objecting to the withholding of his requests through FOIA to get information, and they have been they basically just cold-shouldered him, and they don't have the legal standing to do it. And so he's gotten it at least that far, and I think they're just, if you know, it's still continuing on, I believe, and I think it's just a matter of them playing out the clock, the way the court system can go so slow. The right to a speedy trial, this just doesn't exist anymore. So that's what's happening there. But you know,
before you go on, there's something. There's a video about Chatfield Rentals about the.
Are you able to give me information?
Yeah, he's not going to give him the information. Listen, how he'll make an excuse.
On a certain date.
Yeah.
For what? That's the attitude we get.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm blowing your cover, man.
For a certain date, are you able to give that information? Why make me keep asking?
Why do you want this information?
Because I'm a concerned citizen.
Yeah, man. The moon is made of cheese. Now, what were you saying?
Man, I had not heard that before. I really, that's so. See, people don't even have a brain in their head sometimes. They will immediately misunderstand what's the important thing here. Wolfgang says it point blank. He says, why do you keep asking me that? It's like, you know, I've asked you, can you please provide that? And you will not answer yes or no. You instead ask me why I want it. What? It's like people want power, even though they have no right to it. They're working in a job, let's say, as a government bureaucrat or as a private citizen in some capacity. You know, they may be the bank teller. They may be the shoe shiner. It doesn't matter. But when people do things like that, it's their grab for glory. It's like they want to control a situation. And they could always just say instead, well, A, it's not my right to, so I'm going to treat this person fairly, no matter what I think they want this information for, or, you know, I'm just going to give it to them like I would anyone. And then the other situation is for them to simply answer the question, and if it's accurate, you know, that they can withhold it, then you say that. Sir, I'm allowed to ask you why, because I'd like to know, it's my right in the, under this job to withhold it if I'm concerned you might use it for some nefarious reason or something. You know what I mean? But they don't. People are weak sometimes, and they just start basically acting like authoritarians, you know?
Yeah, but isn't the Patriot Act somewhere it says, like, the government can spy on you, but you cannot ask them what they're spying you for? You have no right to know that?
Yeah, like they could take your internet records from your ISP. It shows everything, and they'll get it from them. But then they are forbidden from contacting you and telling you what happened. They have to stay quiet about it, like nothing happened. You know, it's kind of like don't ask, don't tell. It's kind of like that. What? Which obviously, you remember the gay military gay.
They revealed that, didn't they?
Don't ask, don't tell. Well, it's like, you know what? It's just more secrecy crap is what it sounds like to me. It's ridiculous. There's too much secrecy. Chris, I'll tell you the bottom line of all this, in my opinion, and this is the worst way for some people to start a conversation. That's why I can tell you now. But if I said this, the first thing that came out of my mouth, you would immediately, everyone would be suspicious. And they would have the right to, I think. But it's always the problem with all this stuff is the secrecy that they employ. Well, and the reason they can do that, and like you and I cannot, we don't even think about withholding information as secret in most cases because we don't have the authority to, but they do. And so that authority is what they have. Well, listen to this. The point I make, the reason why I bring this up is it's secrecy first. And it's because of the authority they have that secrecy. But the basic weakest link in this chain is where the hell does that authority come from? Because it's basically produced by people like you and me who grant that authority to these people. But most of us do it totally anonymously. We usually don't even know who they are. We'll look at someone wearing like dressed in military garb with some medals, and we will give them the authority because we assume they're in the military. They could just be an actor, but that's how we are as a society here in America, and it's been worse over the years now. And that's why I feel like if we could just get people to see,
that's where the dominoes will start falling down. When these people are asked to testify in Congress, according to Wolfgang Halbing, the dominoes are going to go down. Before we go on, I want to get this one.
His daughter was also unharmed.
He grabs her by the throat. What does that freaking tell you? He keeps grabbing her by the throat because she wants to blow his cover.
Doesn't piss you off? I remember that too. That was the Wasik girl, I think.
Two days later, Robert. Speak to him. We make sure we understand what he's feeling.
He keeps grabbing her by the throat. Let her talk.
Things that can't be explained. And we take stock in our faith and in our community, our neighbors and our friends who have been just.
Come on, man.
And that's the father who's wearing the gray sweatshirt in that footage with the daughter.
The black sweatshirt.
Well, they went all
It was like motorcycle clothes.
Well, I'll tell you what, it's funny because that was the same, that's the guy who, they did do a couple costume changes, or let's just say clothes changes, where on the same day even, at the firehouse, because they were one of the few families who kept, basically they just kept that girl there all day into the evening. Wasn't she out of school when there was a horrible shooting, supposedly, and the family just wanted to keep, giving their accounts time after time all through the day. It looked like they got pretty stressed out there in the end. And the girl was just, it's hard to watch because you feel like, who can come and can't they have like a family member come and get the kid away at least?
They probably wouldn't do that. And here's another one. Yeah. Where's Robbie Parker, fake actor? You see him like smiling, and then he pretends to be like sad. Come on, man, you're not fooling me. I'm not exactly. a robot. You're not fooling me. I don't know.
You got it, man. I feel exactly the same way. We didn't cover that. We didn't cover any of the reactions, any of the emotions or expression stuff. We skipped over that because none of us chose to do it.
Yeah, and this is one Sandy Hook, Robbie Parker actor, getting into character. You see him smiling at the first 10, 11 second. He's showing his teeth, and then eventually starts to get sad at 15. You know, not bad acting, kid.
It's method acting. You know, where
it's crisis acting.
Yeah, it's not method acting. It's some kind of name, I forget. But the point is that actors who have done that before will tell you, yeah, that's exactly what you would do. Well, you don't have to go from one extreme to the next. But when you want to go from, let's say, just a bland, like a blank, you know, person expression or energy, you can go all the way from one thing, from that blank one to another by doing that, getting into character, and it's a process. And so Robbie Parker appears to be at least skilled as an actor in doing that. Now, that doesn't mean that he can cry.
Like Wolfgang said that he's going to just spew you all kinds of bull. Don't talk to him. There's no point in talking to him. He doesn't want to talk to him, actually.
I would say that's probably not a bad... See, that's how I feel about this.
I would like to talk to him, but the thing is, this will probably have to be done off air. You know?
I'll tell you, man. I'll tell you right now. Yeah, exactly. But like, you know, I one time heard someone call Ryan. And they called and got at least a few words with Ryan. That was it. And I would just say, I do not know for sure. You know who it was? Anyway, he wasn't anyone from our group or anything, but he was one of these guys out there on the wider net. And he obtained the cell phone number, apparently, and I believe also the direct line office number to Ryan Lanza. And he worked for that securities, I forget which one, but at any rate, that's what he did. He called, he got the person to answer the phone at his home through one of those numbers, I guess the cell phone, and he asks him, hi, is this Ryan? And he goes, yeah, who's calling? You know, that type of thing. And he goes, well, I just, and then he said something that wasn't perfect or whatever, and then Ryan just hung up. And then that was it. Then the next day he calls again at his office number to, you know, call back, and because he had called the day prior and got a voicemail there. He left a message. The next day, though, when he calls back after this experience talking to him on the phone at home, just for a moment, that extension was no longer valid. He on the phone said that number.
He changed it. And Wolfgang said that one guy said, "Oh, I'm gonna arrest you if you call this number again." Just like the porta potty video.
It could have been anyone there, but it wasn't Ryan in that case. So Ryan is supposedly, you know, Adam's older brother. Blah blah blah. But a lot of things could have happened there. Ryan could have been. I'm just throwing this out there. It's one of the possibilities. It wasn't like in the documentary, but it was. All along the way, it was one of the possibilities floating around in my head, and that was that Ryan might have been the intended patsy, right? So in other words, they chose Ryan as part of the operation, and he knew what his job was, and maybe he knew, you know, some of the more, you know, nefarious stuff, if there was any of that. Was anyone going to get hurt or not? Probably not. But either way, Ryan was going to be the one. But then my theory of how it could have changed is that Ryan may have been assumed to be on board 100%. Because all these other folks on the day of, or the date of the 13th when this stuff started to play out, at least it started to go through the motions, Ryan, everybody else showed up, but Ryan decided no way, he bailed. And so he never even made it to Sandy Hook. He may have been still in New Jersey at the time, you know, and that kind of thing. And then what happened is, I'm assuming it was so unexpected, they began to figure, well, what can we do? We're out of options here with Ryan. He's gone. We can't get to him quickly enough. What do we do as an alternative? And I'm thinking that's where they may have just invented Adam out of whole cloth at that point, having no other alternative, you know, because... Remember now, what Ryan did was very smart. He jumped on a bus, and he got on Twitter and Facebook, and he said, F you, it wasn't me. And it was from his account, so they had a lot of hurdles to jump through if they could somehow, if they were able to, and maybe he even had someone on the bus with him take a picture of him and tweet it, or, you know what I mean? He established that Ryan Lanza is here on this bus right now, and I'm alive. So if they try to say anything otherwise, so it might have really thrown a monkey wrench in this thing. Just a possibility. Something to think about. Because where's Ryan now? Have you ever even heard of Ryan? Have you ever seen him in live video other than that one time?
he probably has a gag order. He probably can't talk to the camera, sign a paper. Okay, keep your mouth shut.
Oh, yeah, but it's been 2 years. You know, when is that going to lift?
That's never going to lift because the whole town's in on it. It could be forever.
I get you. It's the whatever principle. Yeah, that's why, yeah.
The sky's the limit. The sky's the limit. If you don't stand up to corruption, the sky's the limit. That's the quote.
Yes, you're exactly right. Yes, in other words, they'll just keep smacking you, you know, and you'll say, okay, now is that enough smacks? Nope, smack again, you know. You're right. I think it is dangerous. It's almost psychotically repetitive.
It's psychological stuff. And somebody keeps pointing out, some people keep pointing out MK Ultra stuff is also in there, declassified a long time ago.
Well, that was actually an interesting thing that because of one of the guys I work with and know fairly well, he goes by the name QK Ultra, right? And he's in a lot of these groups, and he's a really nice person. And he puts a lot into this stuff. And he has an interesting background, so it's very neat to kind of see how that plays into this. But I won't give all the details there, because he remains anonymous, which I don't. But he said to me, I asked him, hey, how'd you come up with that name? I'd never heard of QK Ultra. And he goes, well, actually, well, he says that there was an early story that leaked out after Sandy Hook involved one of the parents or a news person maybe in the firehouse. And they said that on that morning when they were being assigned their roles or they were kind of going over a briefing or something, this person happened to take a peek at what the CIA person's folder read at the top, what the title of was written on the tab of the folder. It said MK Ultraviolet. That's what it said. MK Ultraviolet.
Why would he name himself QK?
I don't know. I mean, he just chose the name as a username. Different name. Maybe he didn't want it to be MK Ultra. So it was QK Ultraviolet, you know? So it's QK Ultra for short. So it was a good name. I like it because it's simple and it's distinct. He's very recognizable. And people do know him as the guy who found the kids at the Super Bowl. So, and he waited on that information for months. I mean, he told me about it, and I sat and looked. I went, wow, I don't know, man. This is really very, it's out there. I'm like, get prepared for, you're going to get, you know. I don't know. I was telling him that, I'm sure he was telling me he was worried that families were going to come and start slapping him in the face, if you know, I'm really coming at him hard for this, because this is really over the top.
By the way, what is this? Why is it like they thank you? Because like something about sensitive, you know, you got to hide it. You're hiding stuff from the public. Newtown official thanks media for how it covered the Sandy Hook anniversary.
It sounds like a David Rockefeller to me.
First selectman Pat Laudra sent a letter to members of the media Tuesday thanking them for their respectful professionalism leading up to the one.
She sounds like she's some kind of Duchess of Crime Town or something. Who the hell would do that?
That's tampering, you know? Evidence in a way, I think.
I know, it's so sad.
What would happen if I would tamper evidence like that?
Well, I would say, number one, this is not unprecedented. We had David Rockefeller said the very same thing at one of these major functions he went to, where I think it was like a Bilderberg conference, and he had all the major media heads there, all of them. And he told them, he got up and said, look, I trust this will be kept in confidence, but I just wanted to thank you. If it were not for the help of all of you media people,
wasn't it this one?
Yeah. It's good stuff.
There's one that he said, that was from Jay Rockefeller, that the internet should have been invented.
Oh, yeah, yeah, let's hear it, man.
Wait, but the thing is that, like, what would happen if I would tamper with evidence? Wouldn't I go to prison for that?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Well, I mean, yes and no. I mean, it really depends. They can,
unless, if I were a billionaire, maybe not, but if... But
well, if you're one of the... If you're just a regular Joe, a good person like you or me are, you know, yeah, they could do pretty much anything if they wanted to. You'd have to be really creative to get out of it, you know, somehow. But you can be, I think, sometimes. It's like Ryan, he lucked out. If like I say, was true, his actions were pretty smart, and he somehow maybe got away, you know, for at least temporarily. Probably pissed him off really bad, too. If they had to change and invent Adam because of Ryan, whoo-hoo! Man, there was probably smoke steaming out of their ears.
And what about when it comes to, like, being, like, a white-faced? You know, when stuff is getting, like, really, they're really getting on putting your feet to the fire, you start to get, like, a deer in the headlights or white-faced. You know, I thought it was, like, telling, like, going to a pharmacy and talking to them about the Cancer the Forbidden Cures movie. I had the creator on. Maybe you have, like, white-face on. Or it'll be like, shut up, kid. We're not supposed to know that. That's the reaction I get. That's the reaction I would get, you know?
Yeah. It's this sad, is, yeah. Is, you're right.
Certain that we stand at a defining hour. And tonight, we lead the world in facing down in one small country. Achieve the universal aspirations of mankind. Peace and security, freedom, and the rule of law. Is a world worthy of our struggle and worthy of our children's future.
Yeah, man, let's kill millions of people. We get applause. Nice job, bro.
You know, that speech was almost identical to one that Reagan had made. Talking about, and he said something too earlier, or maybe it's coming up, where he said, when we achieve that new world order, and we will.
Oh, yeah. Wait, isn't it this one?
Its founders.
We have before us the opportunity to forge for future generations.
Get the hell out
of
here.
A new world order. A world where the rule of law, not the law of the jungle, governs the conduct of nations.
Shut up, conspiracy
when
theorists.
When we are successful,
stop.
And we will be. We have a real chance at this new world order, an order in which a credible United Nations can use its peacekeeping role to fulfill the promise and vision of the UN's founders.
Oh, come on, man. Like I said, I'm making this up, right? Am I making
No, you're not, man. Well, you could be editing it, right?
No, I'm not editing, no.
I know, man. No, I've heard it. I gave you the quote. I told you
the one you were just saying now, where they admit it. Here it is. It's on video.
We are grateful to the Washington Post, the New York Times, Time
that
Magazine,
Dave Rockefeller.
Other publications, whose directors have attended our meetings and restricted their promises of discretion for almost 40 years.
Yeah, control the media.
It would have been impossible for us to develop our plan for the world if we had been subject to the bright lights of publicity. But the world is now more sophisticated and prepared to march toward a world government.
Come on, man. You know.
Yeah. They call it, so see the word use there, the very careful, it's like even when he's speaking to insiders, he still chose to propagandize them by assuming that they wouldn't pick up on his subtle injection of the concept that it was going to be a sophisticated, the society will have grown sophisticated enough to march toward a one world government, as if somehow it's sophisticated to do that. Whereas it's nowhere any better than any other solution on its on just the basis alone of it being a one-world government versus a two-world government.
It's not a one-world government where, you know, we have all cures for diseases. You're not going to suppress anything.
Well,
you're going to have world peace. We're going to end world hunger.
Well, think about the American government system where really we have a two-party system. In other words, if you just get rid of everyone else and look at the U.S. as a world unto itself, we have a two-world order. You know, right now, they're going to take one away and get it down to one, and that's going to somehow make everything great. And I'm not sure exactly how, except in their eyes, they may know some things about
how it
works
for them. Wait, isn't it
this song, America? We're all living in America, America.
that's them showing, like, the moon landing, of how they would reenact it.
America.
They love them.
Yeah, so Justin Brewer and I. Don't mind me. I'm just a random guy.
Well, it's like when you see the, you know, they like to show. It's not just the moon landing and stuff too. It's all the way to this day. They love showing off their technology and stuff. Like if they can show, you know, how the NSA has a big fancy room with all these servers in it and blinking lights. And maybe just showing like a spacecraft of some kind they're working on. That's it. They love it. That's America.
Do you believe that we landed on the moon?
I don't know. I think we did.
It's just that they reenacted that just to show. If you're gonna do something, you have to plan. So maybe they show the plan. Oh yeah, it's reenacted how the moon looks like.
That's so funny. I think they maybe did it. I think they staged it for America, at least in one case. I think with Apollo 17. I think they staged, which is the last one they went to the moon. They staged that, what they showed us, I think, maybe even weeks after a real mission went. And I don't even know if they were the ones who went. And I think maybe it wasn't them. But when they were in the craft, and they were supposedly, of course, this I mean, you know, in the reenactment version that we got to see in here, I think they were reading from the transcript of the original one of two other different astronauts, if you can wrap your head around that. So in other words, all they had to do is, you know, they probably knew these guys, and they probably were very familiar, just as they were astronauts, they're probably familiar with the technical stuff and the procedural stuff. So they could read through it a few times and get familiar with it and go, no problem, start giving the, you know, reciting the lines that were originally read weeks earlier by the real astronauts who went, and then they read them later. And one of the reasons I believe that was what happened is a real perfect example is they were complaining so much on 17 about one of the problems they had, they claimed, and it's really, really interesting because it makes it sound like this is not something of a fiction writer would write. It's about the pain of trying to move their hands inside their pressurized gloves. And they explained that what happens when the pressurized glove gets pressurized and then you're out on the surface, the glove becomes like the material inside the glove, which is supposed to be soft, becomes like as hard as a brick. It's like sandpaper, and the fingers don't bend. They just stick out, and you have to work really hard to get them to bend at all. But you have to grab things. You have to grab, at least with your thumb and index finger, a tool or, you know, anything. So in these gloves, their hands were turning to hamburger, and they described that their fingernails would be dislocated. They would come off the quick and separate from their fingers in their gloves, and they just had to grin and bear it. And then when they get back in the craft at the end of their EVA, when they get it back in the craft, they would ask permission, can I take my gloves off now? You know, once they're just, you know, taking their suit off for the end of the day's work, because it was a two-day thing there. They got some sleep and did it, you know, whatever. Maybe it wasn't 2 days, but it was two extended, you know, external deals. So it was a lot of work, apparently. Well, when they got back in and they asked, can they take the gloves off, they were, even NASA, who's usually all business, was asked, NASA was saying to them, they were going, how are your hands doing? Do you need a moment to, and they said, oh, you can hear the moans, they claimed. But it sounded like it was reading from a script when I heard the version that America heard. But it didn't read like one. It read like a real story. But it was just acted out by other astronauts. That's one possibility.
But like when it comes to NASA, yeah, I know they're taken over by the people who run New World Order. But they are the people there. Like I'm not saying they aren't good people, but like the ones that they would say, "Oh, shut up, conspiracy theorists." You know, they were like, "Oh no, that doesn't exist, man." They would leave the room when you talk about anti-gravity. That's not classified. You can look it up. We can all research every stuff we're saying. Anti-gravity, scalar, radiant.
The actors don't even want to know. Hey, listen, you know, NASA, is an interesting look. First of all, number one, NASA and the military and a lot of the contractors, it's hard to tell them apart because a lot of these places, I mean, there are contractors who are civilian contractors whose offices are on the Air Force bases, you know, behind, you know, security checks. And then you have NASA, who's integrated with all of that, and different branches inside NASA, where you would never come in contact with these people in any official capacity. You can only imagine what kind of nonsense goes on there. And of course, I say this because from my, you know, personal interactions with people, they've explained what's going on there, a lot of it, and it's just like, you know, what does it take, what kind of nonsense person do you have to be part of an organization within government like NASA that, like I explained, could literally take an entire, you know, mission to the moon, a big historic event, and just fake it again, just go through it like you're a soap opera, and yet you're a scientific institution at the same time. It's just mind-blowingly deceptive.
But like the same people, I was thinking of while you were saying that, Dick Cheney tells NORAD to stand down. Why would NORAD listen to him?
Are you sure about that, sir? Yeah. Why?
We had that order given, I think it was by the president, that authorized the shooting down of commercial aircraft.
No, I was not. I was made aware of it during the time that the airplane coming in to the Pentagon.
It's called shooting the plane down. I think they could have stopped that, but 9/11 had to happen.
It's possible, yeah. I'm not sure exactly what was up with that plane because, like I say, well, like when they staged other things, then why don't they stage all of it? And the plane coming in may have just been one that pulled up right before it hit the building and just flew over it, to allow the missile to then strike. Because you can't really tell. They never showed us anything.
But in
there's
general,
no plane there.
You should be able to shoot it down, shoot a plane down.
True. They have so many missile batteries there. Oh yeah, easily they could have sent. They could have launched 20 AMRAAM missiles, all nuclear tipped, all at once, and they all would have heat sunk that thing immediately. No problem.
But they would not do it. No, we have to go to war. Otherwise, Rothschild. Otherwise, Soros and Cheney are not gonna be happy. We don't want to make We want to make them happy, don't we?
It's really weird. I've gotten more sophisticated with the 9/11 thing over the years, and I've started to understand more about how these groups basically are like, they're all bad guys, and they all know this about each other, but then they go about kind of like acquiring information about each other and spying on each other in a way that's like a big, like a circle jerk thing, where you don't always know who's the most guilty, but you'll get involved in something. And sometimes you'll get involved in a crime and you'll basically piggyback off the crime.
Yeah.
Or you'll jump in and get involved as if you're part of it. And when in reality, you're a separate crime of yours. It's really interesting and it's a lot more complicated to see how this may have been what's going on. But it's still just as corrupt.
But what about when it comes to, like let's say Bush was talking to Sarah McClendon, and she asked Bush, what would the people do if they ever found out the truth about Iron Gate, Iran-Contra? George W. Bush replied, Sarah, if the people were ever to find out what we have done, we'll be chased down the streets and lynched.
Well, yes, absolutely.
Like, we're not calling for violence, but that's actually what would happen.
No, that's his excuse for not being a nice guy and never being honest, you know. Because he has to tell one lie after the other.
What do you expect? People are going to be angry, and then people are like, don't be violent, man. And they'll go and send people right after you.
First of all, number one, I no longer listen to people who say, you can't be violent or you can't do this. It doesn't make any sense to me. All they're doing is they're basically setting the goals after they set the parameters. I say set the goal first and let that dictate the plan.
It's something about problem, reaction, solution. They cause the problem. They make us react. You know, what do they expect us to do?
Well, there you go. And why don't we flip that and start and do it in reverse when we're dealing with these punks later on? And that's why these people, I don't give them any credit. It's like, you know what they do is that these are the kind of people that when they sit down to like to figure out what they're going to do with their lives, what's the wildest thing, like what do you really want to do, the first thing they'll do is probably compromise. They just jump straight to a compromise and they don't even know why. It's like, look, why don't you at least tell, why don't you at least think, like, what's the a pie in the sky? Pick something that's impossible, you know? But they just cannot do it. They have to always be living in that box that they were told. This is the big, this, don't go outside of the box, you know? And they won't. Even if you tell them it's okay.
It's thinking, just for, you know? It's thinking outside the box, to quote Bill Hicks, you know, the third eye. Go Bill Hicks. That's Bill Hicks. That's how we always you know, rest in peace, man. Rest in peace, Bill Hicks.
Yeah, I really liked him. He was a bit cynical, but I mean, you know, he had a right to be.
What was going on?
He was a kid. He got into being a comedian really young. He wasn't even of age. He had to sneak out of the house to go do comedy gigs. It's really interesting.
Oh, really? Wow.
Yeah, he was not in Texas. He was sneaking out with his best friend. And they were both running down to a comedy club and doing gigs. And then sneaking back into the house at night, you know, late at night, no one would know. And then finally, I think that, you know, somebody told on him or they wound up going in his room and he was just, you know, he just put some clothes under the covers or something. But, and of course, I think they got freaked out or something, but then somebody may have told him or. So it wasn't a big explosive, you know, nightmare for him, but. You know, but that's how he got into it. So he's obviously a different kind of guy to begin with. Nobody would normally, you know, if you're sneaking out of the house to go do a, you know, to do a, like an actual gig as a performer, as a professional performer, that's, you know, that's a different kind of person, you know. And not everyone, that's why he got to thinking the way he did, because he started out being a different thinker. You know, he could have gone off and he may have been an autistic person or something. In one sense, you know, and maybe that was where he could have gone at a point in time in his childhood, but then something about the way he was brought up or the environment pushed him in a different direction, and he decided instead to go become brilliant, you know, and you know, tell it like it was. And in the end, he died pretty early again. It's not like it's a happy ending, really.
You know, I think they probably got him, you know, with a heart attack gun and crud.
Yeah, sure.
They got him, though. And Mike Rupert, I was thinking about him, too.
And Rupert, I'm not sure if I like who he was because I have my suspicions about his supposed coming out as being a detective in LA. I think there's a lot of weird stuff with that. And that's why, it made sense when he started pushing Peak Oil. Peak Oil was his big thing, and then in the end...
I will tell you, Director Deutsch, as a former Los Angeles police narcotics detective, that the agency has dealt drugs throughout this country for a long time.
And the lady says, no.
Well, but the thing with that statement is that whole
will
event...
Will you please take your seats? I will come back to you.
I don't know if I nailed it. Did I nail it?
Well, it's like overacting in a way. It's like, why is she so upset? She's part of the community there.
You know, I'm glad you're one of those guys that doesn't, you know, criticize whenever I'm trying to, like, be random like this. Because somebody will be like, hey, don't make fun of her. Don't make fun of a woman. See, it's political correctness. It's stuff from the left.
Now, I don't have any rules to, like, what people do when I'm talking to them and stuff. And I don't mind it when people say things that are, like, off-color, if they're like, a joke or serious. That's what really challenges you to understand. Like, even comedy gets really challenging if certain comedians there, you can't even tell they're being funny, some people. You gotta know what they're doing, you know. It's really interesting.
By the way, you could also check out this video, you and anybody who's listening. Okay. 9/11 Mike Rupert, The Truth and Lies 9/11.
Okay. In other words, the people who told Clifford how to write the act were two brothers.
He talks step by step
John
on what's
Foster
it done.
And Alan Dulles.
This is all declassified.
Brothers, Dull, Duller, and Dullest. John Foster Dulles was Secretary of State to President Dwight Eisenhower.
You can watch it for, it's like around 2 hours.
Great. Oh, good. Yeah, I watch all those things. I mean, and I've watched a little Mike Rupert, but I don't think I've watched one about him on 9/11 specifically. But I did watch his, he had an actual feature film that's a documentary with just him and he, it's called Peak Oil, or it's called Peak or something like that, and it's not good in the sense that I see it as a very expensive and elaborate operation that's a corporate agenda thing. And it's sad that he got dragged into it. I don't know if it's true, but that's my opinion of it. That's why I started going back and looking through the things, going through all the way back to that LA event. And it looked like a different thing to me then. I suddenly saw it as it was like he was being sheep dipped, as they say. They gave him instant credibility that day by having him stand up and say, I'm a former detective and I can tell you for a fact. And he was talking directly to the director of the CIA, Don Deutsch, who happened to be the only guy on stage. And he also just kind of seemed like, and by the way, a month after that, John Deutsch resigned. He was like, I'm out of here.
I think he's just a puppet. If you're a director of an agency, you're just a puppet. But it doesn't mean that you're stupid or anything. No.
That agency director does seem to come and go.
This is part of the footage of the movie. We talked about Sandy Hook. That's the one of the parents, and it looks like, I don't know if it was the Sunny Side Up show.
They're both actors.
It looks like the Sunny Side Up show from that PBS.
It's like Romper Room or something. It's like Captain Kangaroo. It's just it's insane. It's like she's doing something for kids, and it's like still acting.
Oh yeah, Sprout. That was the case.
And then the husband, David, he goes and films, his big film is the one where he's holding a gun to his head, and it's like a dark gun murder mystery thing.
Yeah, Sandy Hook, if my child were to die, I don't think I would probably go to work. That's called a natural reaction.
That's a natural reaction. Exactly. I had the same effect. I've told people this now, because I had my cat die. And I know people lose pets, but I lost a cat who was my, I've had him for 17 years. His name was Figaro. When he died, just a short few months ago now. In fact, we dedicated the documentary to him. People don't usually know that, but at the beginning of the credits, his picture comes up and it explains it was dedicated to him. Anyway, he died, and he had a real hard last year of his life. But, it's been very hard ever since. For me, and I'll definitely tell you, I had intense grief from just his loss, because he was really my best friend as a cat. I didn't think about it like that until he was gone, then I realized it was true.
And then to call back to Wolfgang, this is Wolfgang Halbig, Sandy Hook Stage Government Community Capstone Exercise False Flag.
Prepared for, and guess what? We better make sure that every teacher is trained properly, that there is an emergency management plan.
Yeah, fraud. The moon is made out of cheese.
In 1994, when I became a director of school safety, the first thing I realized in my school district of 65,000 students, we had no plan.
He smiles, but like just to like not to make anything less serious, but he's trying to explain himself. It looks like he's smiling, but he's not joking. Do you have any idea what he's going through right now?
You mean Wolfgang specifically right now?
Yeah. Could you imagine him being in the guy's shoes? He's like persecuted.
Well, that's the thing. I don't have any problem with Wolfgang, and I don't know him directly. We've had a couple of communications, but real brief. And I thought for a while that I should approach him about doing a documentary about just him, focusing on him.
Do that.
Well, listen, though, here's the thing. It's volatile, He is he would be a great subject for this, and we would have carte blanche, because no mainstream group, nobody in mainstream media is allowed to touch Wolfgang as a documentary. There's no doubt.
Why?
But if this was not a conspiratorial story that was off limits, he would have been jumped on so early, and they would have been taking his documentary to Sundance, the story behind it is, what's going to happen in that documentary? The pursuit of his, just kind of watching and observing his pursuit of justice and how that plays out. Well, that's the longer term. It's also something that limits our, like, if we were going to do something now, we're working on a project right now, Chris, and it's,
you can't say it.
I can't say what it's about, right, but I can say that it's a new topic, and it's one that, you know, if we were to work on it, and it was like the Wolfgang Hallbeck thing, where we were kind of, it's a reality thing, we have to kind of stay with him for a period of time. Well, we couldn't put it out in less than a year. Yeah. You know, we want to do this thing and do it in 4 months, you, start to finish. You said,
you said the media is not allowed to touch on Wolfgang Hallbeck.
Well, they certainly wouldn't be allowed to produce a documentary on
him.
Yeah,
man. See, and people get sold. People are like, right, oh, it's you know, media, you know, he's a fraud, man. Come on.
Yeah.
And you shouldn't pull any punches to do that, you know. Because they want to be secretive. They don't want us to know about stuff, but they want to know about us. They want to spy on us. And they find out you're doing a documentary, and they say, oh, no, here comes this conspiracy theorist. What is Peter Klein doing? Why won't he talk about his project now? Hey,
it's because you're crazy. You're unstable.
Why won't you talk about it? Why won't you talk about your project yet?
Why won't I? Are you really asking me?
No, I'm just. That's
what they're gonna. Hypothetically.
Yeah. Why wouldn't you tell them?
Oh gosh, I'll tell you one thing: is because you psycho mainstream media weirdos, and also in the government, and you know, you really like having that control, and you like having the power and the money. And you have all the tools at your disposal. And then you're going to want me to give you advance notice of the topic of our documentary.
Yeah,
you're going to sit there and make all your weapons so you can attack us.
We can't know about Roswell. We can't know about Roswell. We can't know about JFK. We can't know about that stuff. But you want to find out what am I doing on Facebook?
Yeah, you want to spy on children's through their laptops that the school donates to them.
By the way, that reminds you of Gary Cardori. He exposed that there was homosexuality, pedophilia from the Bush administration, and they put a bomb in his plane and killed him.
The military's been turned into a home. Like, for instance, the Marines is getting that way. It's getting real, like, you know, these guys they're confused, some of them, too. But, you know, hey, they get these initiation kind of parties going. They get drunk.
Yeah, but it's almost like an election. Oh, yeah, America's choice, man. Vote, man. Yeah, I don't do anything. This country's freaking controlled. It's a charade, like Carlin says. You know?
Well, you know what? You would probably feel a lot better about voting for a politician if he was on a reality TV camera show thing where his camera was on him nonstop, period. And if he was like that, like Big Brother, but it was just on him, so that you could literally just watch as much or as little as you want. And if anyone said, did you see that thing he did, and you were worried, you would go watch it. Okay. In other words, if you could keep tabs on his every move or her every move, well, then you know what? If he does it long enough and he keeps himself clean and he can improve, then you know what? Hey, it's all about surveilling government.
Yeah,
and they want no surveillance at all. They want to turn the cameras on us. They're out of their minds.
And by the way, this is one from Carlin.
But there's a reason. There's a reason. There's a reason for this. There's a reason education sucks. And it's the same reason that it will never, ever, ever be fixed. It's never going to get any better. Don't look for it. Be happy with what you got. Because the owners of this country don't want that. I'm talking about the real owners now.
Yeah.
The big, the wealthy.
Come on. Am I lying?
The real owners, the big wealthy business interests that control things and make all the important decisions. Forget the politicians. They're irrelevant. The politicians are put there to give you the idea that you have freedom of choice.
You don't.
You don't. You have no choice. You have owners. They own
own everything.
They own everything. They own all the important land. They own and control the corporations. They've long since bought and paid for the Senate, the Congress, the state houses, the city halls. They got the judges in their back pockets. And they own all the big media companies, so they control just about all of the news and information you get to hear. They got you by the balls. They spend billions of dollars every year lobbying.
Am I lying?
No, you're not. No. You know, but it's not true, though.
I bet you money.
It's not true that it can never change, because I'll tell you right now, if it changed, it would just be one switch. It would be like, all we needed is enough people to hear Carlin's statement for us to realize, oh, wait, they do keep grabbing us by the balls. So maybe if I just decide one day I'm going to put a taser on my balls, boom, And there it is. So all we got to do is the first step. And that really does, basically, it's like, I feel that would be the step, it would be like a revolution that wouldn't require much more than that. They would cower in fear the moment we ever showed them that we saw them. You know, we see you. But it's over. They're gone.
And,
you know?
And, you know, what about Bill Hicks explains U.S. president? I'm trying not to get it. Like, I'm trying to get the curse.
I have this feeling, man, because you know there's a handful of people actually run everything. That's true. It's provable. It's not. I'm not a conspiracy nut. It's provable. Handful, very small elite run and own these corporations, which include the mainstream media. I have this feeling who's ever elected president, like Clinton was, no matter what your promises you promise on the campaign trail, blah, 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 when you win, you go into this smoky room with the 12 industrialists, capitalist scum fucks who got you in there, and you're in this smoky room, and this little film
George Soros.
Screen comes down, and a big guy in a cigar, roll the film, and it's a shot of a Kennedy assassination from an angle you've never seen before. That looks suspiciously off the grassy knoll. And then the film, the screen goes up and the lights come up and they go to the new president. Any questions? Just what my agenda is.
Bomb Iraq, bomb Syria, you know, kill a lot of children. That's what we should do. Right, sir? Yes, Mr. President, we got to do that. We got to.
We could do a better comedy bit than that now, I feel like, because, you know, it's been enough time even still since Bill Hicks with that comedy bit. Because really, I thought what really happens is probably a little similar, except I think what they do is it's kind of like the way the world works with the president and with this top, you know, this very sensitive information. Is they already have this, and it's a global security clearance system. It respects no nation. It doesn't matter if you're the president. Oh. That's worth nothing. It's what is your clearance level. And you could be someone from Al-Qaeda. It doesn't matter. If you have the clearance, you will simply be issued the file. The clearance is the thing that's like it's like the priesthood of the modern era. Is the rank and file, you know, that allows you to move through the priesthood in America in the world today is security clearance. And so really, you know, it doesn't really matter what you plan the agenda to be and all that. But at the same time, it doesn't matter for these guys who are in the room. Who are the industrialists?
Yeah,
they don't have the security clearances. They want to give those security clearances to trusted partners. Who can do the work and who can ensure them that they don't know what the full plan is?
It's on a business, you know, at the business table, and this is where he.
The renegade physician agrees to.
This
fly
is conspiracy theory, Jesse Ventura. He talked to Dr. Emily Vo. I've talked to her recently.
They go okay. Only for a brief time.
And sterility.
Doctor, the response is going to be, "You're crazy. How can you say this stuff?"
I show them the documentation.
She's been for decades a physician.
This process has already been ongoing. To make matters worse, we know that the vaccines that were illegally approved by the FDA contain a substance called squalene.
Squalene, an organic compound used in vaccines to stimulate the immune system and increase the response.
They will induce a pandemic using
it's a bioweapon. Release the bioweapon.
Vaccine, which is a live Project attenuated to virus.
The black
that
people.
Means that if I take it, I can infect you.
I talked
You're
to her
going
about
to get the flu. Everybody around us is going to get the flu. Then the United States government, based on their statements that they've already made, will say, "Oh my, we have a pandemic. Oh my." 1,000 U.S. military swing into
that's what
action.
That's what's going to come down to. If there will be a revolution. But they want to make it a martial law.
Not long ago.
Yeah, they want to stop crimes. You know, you have militarized the police. You have to. Yeah, there's a reason why they might all militarize the police. Think, people.
To, among other things, relocate the population in the event
Agenda
of
21.
Civil disorder,
put them all into cities.
Or pandemics.
Doctor, what you're saying is that if people refuse these vaccinations, that FEMA's
going to... Isn't that what's going on recently with the forced inoculation?
Around the country?
I think you have to leave out the word almost.
Yeah. Doctor, how can you say this stuff?
Let me tell you a story. In 2003, I had a patient in my drug-free medical
practice. She's not going to say who it was. I don't know if you... I don't know who it was.
She said, you know, it's almost time for the great culling to begin.
The what?
That's what I said. The what? She said the great culling, C-U-L-L-I-N-G, when you thin the herd. I said, what are you talking about? She said, it's almost time for the useless eaters to be culled. And she said, those are the people who are consuming our non-renewable natural resources. I said, who are the people who make this decision? She said,
Georgia guides don't say this.
The aristocrats.
This person you talk to, you're bound because you're a physician and there's the relationship that you can't talk. The world's population. Now, what you're saying to me is the Bilderbergs are not the top echelon, that there's somebody above them.
According to what I was told by this woman, there's a council of seven men and they make long-term decisions about what they want to see happen, which country rises, which country falls, which economies prosper. And it's really important to understand that these people have no affiliation to a religion, no affiliation to a nation, no affiliation to a political party. They are acting according to their own rules and their rules.
Come on, like, how clear can this get?
Well, listen, you know, it isn't clear in the way, this is the way I see it. Everyone loves the idea that these folks are declaring their position, they're setting goals, and these goals can be understood, regardless if they sound conspiratorial or not. They're going to cull the population, or they're going to, cause a pandemic. Right? There will be an intentional pandemic and all that. But here's the thing that we need to remember. Over history, we see these people have had great power, they've had great control, they have had enormous wealth, and they do these things that appear to be little versions of maybe a pandemic, like with the polio vaccine. I mean, what is polio in the first place? What is Ebola? Can you even get Ebola, or do you have to be injected with it? You know, we don't know. You and I, a medical doctor will tell you they know.
They'll tell you what they're told to tell you.
Exactly. And that's the point I'm making, is that this is the thinking out of the box part. If you think all the way out of the box, you'll start seeing that what they seem to be doing is they seem to be like shucking and jiving. You know, they move and they fake left. They throw a Hail Mary all of a sudden. It's like you don't get the story. They tell you maybe a story they want people to think for a little while, but even that they don't support. And then they go on to do something that you totally had no idea was coming. And they always keep us here. And they never put too much effort into it. They never push too far. It's like a subtle force that exists that tells people to do one thing or another and moves you a little bit closer to the goal of, let's say, a police state. You know, they give all these cops all this equipment, but it's not only because they want a police state. Remember, what they need to do is they need to start getting money flowing through, too. That's another point. And also, they need to do something with a lot of equipment sometimes that they used to just do. They used to do other things with it. But now they see the opportunity to ingratiate themselves with the local law enforcement because they want to federalize law enforcement. Just not necessarily to kill everyone, but maybe because they like... Maybe they can do more with control locally that they can't now. And it doesn't matter what it is they want to do, but it would be helpful if the local forces, you know, the cops felt like they were being pampered, you know, like here, have a RAV, an MRAV, or some body armor for your people. And you know what? In the end, yes, the police state is a horrible part of this. But, you know, I think everyone has thought about at least for a little bit what it would be like in martial law in America. And it seems like, you know what, yeah, we saw little tastes of this during New Orleans, during Boston. We get a little taste, and it looks bad. But we never see what it would happen if it was instigated for real and permanent, like a real shock, and it happened nationwide, and we did that for like a week. Because I don't think we'd live, I think at the end of a week, there would be rebel forces rising up, and they would already be conducting operations to take out this. And they would be negotiating with them, too. It doesn't have to be violent. They would probably place some phone calls. It'd be like a General McCarthy
General. Speaking of phone calls, they could also call you by an unknown number. Hey, what is this? Or a private number. And they could threaten you like that.
Well, they could threaten you, or they could call and say, hey, you know what? You remember we told you about the, you know, blah, blah. And they can say, yeah. And you can really start showing, hey, here's the reality, man. You know, who are you doing this for, number one? And a lot of these cops, you know, on the lower ranks, and that's where they're going to be. They don't know the big plan. And they can have handlers. They can be watched. They can all of that. But ultimately, the people who really make the call in military and law enforcement, they're not watched. I mean, they go off, they do what they want to do. They may not know the full story, but they know what the mission they have is. And if they decide to use their heads and think it through, a lot of them will decide to make other plans. They may not even know why it would be bad for, let's say, the plan. You know, the bad guys have a plan, let's say. And now the local generals want to, you know, they think, oh, you know what? I think it would be better if we went around here to the west. And, oh, boy, they may not even understand that that would totally destroy the plan. But they'll do it, and then suddenly they'll be in a bad spot, and they won't be as effective. And the globalists cannot have that level of control. You know, that I will say globalists, just for lack of a better way, the cabal, the evil guys.
Zionists.
You know, Zionists or whomever, but I'm thinking on an even higher level. There may be some... spiritual forces. I don't want to even describe which kind of, just, I'm thinking that a lot of this stuff seems to play out over the course of a number of generations, and there's just no way to explain it without getting into the dimensional or spiritual stuff, or essentially people who can breach time, at least in their minds somehow. Because that's, without that ability, I don't see how this all comes together and works. It seems too magical. Hell, the crossing of the Delaware has stories that just never seem to add up. It seems like whenever they try to do something that's important, and it really is somehow, it doesn't even need to be a big thing. It just needs to be the thing that was the key. Then suddenly that thing just gets swept through history, and it happens. And it just seems to be almost like it's being carried, you know. And that's the case of the stupid thing, like the crossing of the Delaware is one example of a scenario like that, where historically it should not have happened as it did, and yet it did. And that makes me wonder about what abilities we have in reality to go either forward or to view forward or backward in time. And how would that help us in a, you know, at a time when we might need it? Or if we just wanted to be able to know where we're headed, because we could maybe shift our actions just enough to make sure that we were going to be, you know, getting a little more out of it than we wanted. I don't know. Very confusing to think about all that. But I think it's worth putting at least a little bit of thought. And it's always good to throw stuff like that in there, because I think that's what these bad guys do, in a sense, that they really get a kick out of, and that is just kind of keeping the tables flipping, you know, keeping things moving. You got to keep it, it's like juggling. You got to juggle and just keep it rolling. And that helps them not worry about any one of those balls being dropped at any time. Because if they stay too focused on one, or if they slow down and stop juggling, boy, we're good. You know, the people are smart. Eventually, they'll see that we can't do that. We'll get them then, you know.
By the way, there was this video from, I'll take this one from Info, Shocking History of the CIA. There's, it talks with about a guy,
was the most decorated Marine of all time.
He wanted to overthrow.
The conspirators believed he could command a rogue army of 500,000 World War I veterans to stage a coup d'etat and overthrow the United States government. The plan to install a fascist dictatorship by force was exposed when Major General Smedley Butler blew the whistle and identified the ringleaders in a testimony given to the United States House Committee on Un-American Activities. The committee concluded that Butler's allegations were true, but incredibly, no one was charged.
No,
the
majority
of the media blackballed.
I get in trouble for me.
Prescott Bush, who is the father of George Bush Sr. and the grandfather of George W. Bush, went on to help finance Hitler's rise to power.
Former MI6
even continued business dealings with the Nazis well after America entered the Second World War. It wasn't until his company's assets were seized in 1942 under the Trading with the Enemy Act that his financial ties with Nazi Germany were finally dissolved. At the end of World War II, Operation Paperclip was launched by the Office of Strategic Services, the OSS, to smuggle known Nazi war criminals into the United States for recruitment into U.S. intelligence agencies. The Nazis were cleared to work in America after having their backgrounds bleached by the military.
That's what they're doing to the illegals, actually. And they're going to vote to take away the guns.
Industrial complex. And by the end of Eisenhower's presidency in 1961, it had become evident that the federal government could no longer control the agency. The CIA had gone rogue.
Well, they ain't the only one. I would say the FBI, I would also say the Department of Justice, the Treasury. You know, I've written a lot of articles on my blog, and one is about how I discovered that the United States Department of Agriculture was headquartered in Puerto Rico and in an apartment. sounds unbelievable, but it's true. Now, why is it true? Well, because they needed an ultimate, like, high-level, top-end box that wasn't in America, which would possibly cause them to become liable to some kind of potentiality, but ultimately they needed to be able to get their mail. And it's just like it is in the when you incorporate your business in Delaware. There are homes or businesses that are small little, you know, like a two-story thing, but maybe only four offices in it. And the whole thing is nothing but a mail drop. It'll have like 2,000 mailboxes in there. And so it's just so people can get their mail. But ultimately, in Puerto Rico, that's not America. And it is where, in fact, the IRS is headquartered as well. Now, the Treasury, I don't know, but the Department of Department of Agriculture to be there is a little unique, and that caught me off guard. But it does raise the flag that, yes, in terms of agencies gone rogue, I don't know how much more rogue
it's
you can
worse
keep.
Than this.
I'd like to get
this
into
this the former head of CBS.
Had been contacted by the CIA.
With the CIA.
As a matter of fact, by the time I became the head
Mass
of the whole
media.
News and Public Affairs operation in 1954, ships had been established, and I was told about them and asked if I'd carry on with them.
Wow, like, and yeah, people watch CBS.
Yeah, I did a whole lot of research, Chris, on the media before I began work on the Sandy Hook project, because that was what I was doing next, was something I was going to do on the media personally for my channel. And so I researched it for a few months, and the first thing I did is I wanted to get a better historical view. So I went back and I started around the time of, you know, the kind of the tail end of the Depression, but it was after World War I, but not yet really. We weren't going to war yet as a nation with Germany. It was right around that time. So then I saw right away all of that was really the real birth. I could say that we could skip World War II and just go right into that immediately post-World War II time where, you know, America was getting to really enjoy their victory status as a nation, as a power center, and as a producer that had free time, and they consider all of this to be the way things should be. Well, they started consuming and all that. Well, it turns out all the major media was established right from the get-go by former military intelligence officers or people who were compromised in a way. You know, like even TV Guide was founded by a guy and his dad who had just been convicted of the worst example, the highest level embezzlement ever in America. So it was the largest, you know, dollar figure in an embezzlement crime. Those guys get convicted. They don't do any time. It's like they get a slap on the wrist, and the next thing you know, they've just founded Time Magazine. I'm sorry, no, TV Guide, TV Guide. And then you go further, you see Time Magazine is completely screwed. Life is completely corrupt from the start. Life is so connected to the intelligence agencies that some people started to see a parallel between a phenomenon in society and articles in Life magazine. And one example was Jan Irving of Gnostic Media. He was researching one of the authors of an article in 1968 in Life magazine on psychedelic mushrooms. It was the first publicly available editorial piece. It was really long, and it was about psychedelic mushrooms. And then literally that very month, you began to see mushrooms became available in cities on the East Coast, the West Coast, and it spread in 3 months to just saturation point. And how the hell is that a coincidence? So that's an example right there. They want to get the kids away from anti-war stuff. And because we had Vietnam, so then they give them this drug culture.
Of course, they want to draft them. So you know, if these wars that are a fraud, they want to just keep going. Isn't it true that the U.S. Army is like in Afghanistan watching opium fields?
Well, I would say I don't have proof, but it's basically no other way can you view this.
Come on.
And a long time ago, I watched a video of a helicopter. It was just a helicopter ride across the countryside of Afghanistan. And I want you to know, it was beautiful, first of all. It was lush. It was amazing. But every single plot of land was being farmed with a really big, lush, fertile, very successful crop, and it just kept going and going, and every one of those was a field of opium poppies being grown, the whole thing. So it has to be us, what else is doing it?
Meanwhile, people go to jail for a little pot of weed. We laundering the drug money, etc. Yeah.
Oh, they'll put people in jail for years, even still, for having a joint. I'm not sure how that works anymore, but they still do it. I don't know what they're going to do with these people. They're in there.
It's a negotiation with the private companies and stocks and all that. And there's another one. This is a guy from Cuba, was it? They put up like a bomb in the plane.
In 1976, flight 455, which took off from Venezuela bound for Cuba, suddenly exploded. All 73 passengers and 5 crew members aboard died after the plane crashed near Barbados. Four of the terrorists were found to be Latin Americans contracted by the U.S. One of the attack's masterminds, Posada Capriles, currently lives freely in Miami.
What does that tell you?
What did you say again? What was the word you said?
He's a free man.
Oh, free man. Okay. Yeah.
And there was another where this senator and his wife and daughter and like a few other people were killed also. That was another story.
Well, I'll need to get going. We need to wrap it up. It's been a few hours. Well, now it's been a couple, 2.5 hours now.
Yeah.
I thought it was very interesting.
By the way, what you respect Wolfgang's work, isn't it?
Right? Oh, do I? Yeah, sure.
And people keep saying he's a fraud. What do you think? I know. What do you think on the Sandy Hook hoax documentary? Some people made their own. One that's like 3 hours. I think it's longer than yours, actually.
I've seen a lot of that one. I don't watch a lot of other people's stuff. I tend to be very, I can't do it all. I don't think many people could and get anything done. So I have to kind of take bits and pieces in. It's even harder with some of the people that I look up to and some of the research and you know, the great thinkers that I'm able to, lucky enough to know. And I can barely, I wouldn't even ask them to watch something. And I totally, I don't even expect them to watch my stuff half the time, at least. But just because they're, it's too much, you know, they're inundated with it. So I pick and choose what I can get to, and sometimes I'm really, it takes a long time before I finally get it. Well, you know, the one that's the longer one, if it's the one by Brendan Hunt, it's not that great. I'm not, he has been really, he's a real divisive character. I don't know what happened to him. I think he's a narcissistic person. He just, you know, I went to his website finally, and that's at brendanhunt.com, I believe. And he is, you know, an actor. I mean, he's not hiding that or anything. But he, after I watched some, I read through some of his site, it became clear that he is a shameless self-promoter. So that's really not a good thing if you're going to be in this kind of thing where you're exposing, you know, if you really want to fight for the people, you cannot do it and shamelessly self-promote at the same time. It just doesn't work. So he can't, he's got good stuff in there, and he does some good work. It's just that nowadays I have to just say, you know.
Wait, why wouldn't that work, like, all selflessly promoting yourself at the same time?
Well, because self-promotion to that level is pure narcissism. Oh. And it's just clouds the mind. It means that the goal, your goal must somehow be compromised by this ulterior motive, right? It's better to just go ahead and declare yourself. You know, it's like this. It's not even necessarily something he knows about. It may not be intentional. It may be in, like, a part of his personality as a, you know, wanting to be an actor. It's just very interesting to see the way his reality is distorted slightly to cover some of the his shortcomings or failings in his acting career. I noticed right away some of the things that he was describing, or that you read in that personal website of his, was show, you know, to me show, and this has had nothing to do with any conspiracy or Sandy Hook. It just made it clear that he is kind of living in a lie a little bit, you know, willing to accept the way things are as a deception, essentially, to kind of just help him feel like he's, you know, still got a chance as an actor or to feel better overall. I'm not sure, but I'd rather just avoid it because he just accuses people of things. You know, he accuses me. He ran my damn mug. He went and dug up my arrest record, and I only have one arrest, and it was, I was pulled over, and so it was, I was, I only, you know, I did a day in jail, and I was overnight. But it was horrible, you know, for him to go dig up. I've never seen it.
They want to find a way to discredit you. That's the thing.
Oh, yeah. Well, I found, I'll tell you.
I get that a lot. I found,
I would appreciate it. I actually saw it as an homage. Like, once I spent a moment or two and thought about it, I went, no. If someone was going to complain about it, they said, hey, let me flag it because that's awful, you know. And I said, no, let me think about it. And I say, just leave it up there. I like the fact that they tried to dig dirt up on me and they tried to make me look like a bad guy and they couldn't do it. They just couldn't do it. Wow. So might as well just leave it, you know?
But why do most people not believe the real truth if something were to happen? Like, you could put all the proof out there and people still deny it.
I'll tell you one reason right now is the people, the way you deliver it.
I think people are like in a trance right now. People are being
True, but you know what? It has to do with the feeling you get when you hear the truth. Is you're usually given it, and you have a fear built in that is, you fear the truth being negative. Like, what if the truth was you only had a day to live? If somebody gave you that truth, that person would be a negative force. You know, you would want to avoid it. But here's the thing. That's not very realistic, but it doesn't matter, apparently. We have this inside of us. It's not a fear of the truth. It's a fear of negative truth, or truth that's bad for us. And so we need to be protected. So we just kind of default to, you're bad. What? I don't want to hear it, you know? But you can help people by giving them the truth, by doing it in a, like, depending upon if you know this person well, or if you've kind of been even sharing any of this stuff that's a little lesser known. You will decide how to do it, but it's maybe a good idea to start really light by asking them about things. Like, let's say you and I know the significance of some legislation that's being passed, but no one else has even heard of it. And we know so much about it that we can tell people, this bill, this HR 23 or whatever, is horrible. It's the worst thing ever. You must understand this. Do something about it. You know, don't do that. Ask them instead, what have you heard about this bill? And if they say no, go, you know, it's like 22, blah, blah, and help them feel like they're learning about it with you. So it's not like you're giving them the truth. You're just basically kind of coaxing it, coaxing them along. You know what I mean?
Wow.
It's an easier way to deliver the truth when people are going, like I tried this many, many times with people. And I'll tell you, I lost a lot of like good potential friends or just good times where things would have been really, you know, more generally a better environment, happy, you know, upbeat. When, because I was trying to share my conspiracy news with people, you know, I was like, they saw it as, oh boy. They didn't get it fast enough. So it was like they never got the joke. And I would be starting to get frustrated with them, and they could tell that I wasn't like, you're not having fun right now, are you? You know, well, obviously I'm not, but, you know, they didn't get why don't you just have a good time with it? You know, well, that's why you basically, you know, then that person wouldn't stop, like maybe they would stop going to lunch with you as often at work or something. Until the next thing you know, they just, it's,
and
you just
then,
give up
and
on
and then
them.
When you are right, there's no apology whatsoever. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry I doubted you, man. You could lose a boyfriend, girlfriend. You could lose contact with your parents like this.
It's going to be worse. I tell people all the time, once the cabal and all the evil, once the government corruption is literally like the dominoes have all fallen real fast, some of those jerks are gonna suddenly pop up amongst our ranks, and they're gonna be claiming, oh boy, we did it, guys. You know, they're gonna be jumping ship and pretending they were here all along. Guys like Glenn Beck, all of a sudden he'll appear and be like, oh wow, what a trip, guys. And we'll just have to shrug him off and go, well, what do you do? You know, because people will do that. They'll try to claim credit. They'll try to tell us they told us all along. They'll be like, I was telling you the whole time.
I don't know.
But it's okay, because you know what? It's all going to be worth it. If we can see that happen, I won't care one bit. I'll say, good for you, man. Come over here.
How can we all stop fighting with each other, though? Like, we all fight with each other just because of that. It's a distraction. they could put a freaking, they could nuke a city, and we won't know about it. And then
I'll tell you right now. Yeah, there's a way.
People don't know that way. We have troops in Ukraine. We're fighting the Russians.
Oh, no. See, I don't know, man.
We are.
And just do what you're doing. Nose to the grindstone, you know. Just you do the part you're playing right now. If your goals are, let's say, like with us in this IMS group, we have a goal of producing this documentary, and then that will have a goal attached. But just getting the first part of it done, getting this thing produced, committing to it, knowing the impact it could have, because it's our intent is to make it different with just the right kind of perfectly timed twist, you know, that will take off and potentially be like a viral thing. And I think if it doesn't work, that's fine. It's still going to work in a big way. But if that were to happen, then what do you know? I mean, we could see a change happen now. So instead of putting an end to the fighting right now, we simply redirect our attention to this project because we know we have faith in it. It may not be perfect, but it might do something here. We work on that, and then that might get us to that, you know, peace that you're looking for, where we can stop all that fighting.
By the way, we are actually fighting, this is the New York Times. President Obama's nominee for Secretary of the Coast told senators he would consider increased, that means we are already there, American military assistance to Ukraine.
They subtly shifted the story. Remember, originally, we were totally caught off guard. They do, you know what, I hate to say it, but I want to throw in, if they're doing that now with Ukraine and mentioning that and now admitting that we, meaning the U.S., is there. I would also add lots of parts of the North African continent, you know, North Africa, AFRICOM, has been ramping up, which is our military operations for that region of the globe, you know, Africa and all of its various countries. And that's where you're going to see, you know, that's why he had that, whatever that guy, Coney, those Dan, he had, Angelina Jolie and all the other actors, you know, putting YouTube videos up and tweeting fancy things, telling us we got to get Coney. Oh, save those girls. And those women were never kidnapped. That was all a complete and utter, you know, a fraud in order to buy support to get into the continent of Africa and start getting funds opened up to throw into there to ramp up some kind of operations that they're not part of a war with anybody. They're part of the constant chaotic military actions that go on now with no clear goals. But underneath, of course, they all have an agenda and they do have a clear goal. But they just want to be moving around just enough to make it too hard for us to identify clearly. But you can do your part at least to stop the first step, which is that stupid hoax, that ridiculous lie the media sells, where they play it off like Obama lied to us about not being in Ukraine.
And Obama's like crying and like... crying? What about the kids in the Middle East you're tortured? That's not crying? They're human beings.
Oh, man. Yeah, like I care about Obama's crying when I think about the crying of the tormented in our world. Oh, man. Give me a break. Some of those people that are suffering right now. You know, they find kids sometimes that have never even, they don't even know how to talk. And they live in like a room where they've just been given a meal on a plate. And they've never spoken to anyone, never had a toy, never done anything. And then they have to, and they find these kids. And we're still so twisted as a world that we can't even really ever find a way for their lives to become better because we put them with foster parents and their parents, and they become fascinated with them through science. And so the scientists and psychologists have an unhealthy relationship studying them. And it's just like insane how this world works, you know. That's the worst part of our world is how we try to do good. And all we're doing is we're just basically selfishly abusing and harming all the other creatures. And the smaller the creature, the more harm, you know. It's crazy.
Well, before you go, can you say, like, what message would you want to say to everybody who's listening?
I'll give you one message, and that is this kind of the overriding thing of me lately and why I'm working as hard as I really probably should work, you know, where you don't want to be getting sick. Don't work yourself sick. But basically right now I see a big, big change from how things were really just, you know, a year ago. And I would say people aren't normally seeing this. What I'm seeing is there's a lot of signs that the system has more cracks than we thought. You know, there are lots of vulnerability points. They're like pressure points, and we just didn't know because we never stepped on that pressure point, you know. So we find out these things. Well, that's a real positive sign. And I've learned something about on the good guys' side. Suddenly, I realized that all this fighting between the good guys, you know, and the worrying about who's on whose side and all that.
Stuff like George Soros. He wants us to fight each other.
Exactly. Well,
if
that's
we fight each other, we won't find out the real truth. And then it's a civil war they engineer.
Well, and what I'm saying is that fighting is just looking at the parts of the fight just inside the truth community where maybe we normally see... You know, we may all think virtually the same kind of things or, you know, we may have the same ideas. All of it may be similar, but we still tend to fight. And it's not always intentional. You know, sometimes it's part of our human nature, all that. But it turns out that you and I and people who are just individual citizen journalists, no matter what our interests are, if we have a good heart, it seems like I didn't realize it, but we do seem to know when to jump in together and join forces at times. And we will do it, and we do it occasionally. We don't always see it as obviously, but I noticed it, well, when it happened with our video, we didn't ask for the help. We didn't tell people there was a need for it, and nobody was sure whether it was absolute. And most people felt like it was pretty much, you know, not necessary, but they knew that it was their part because now we had decided as a group, like the 100th monkey effect, we're going to join forces and work together. And so they did stuff to work together that they normally wouldn't have wasted the time to do, in a sense. But it doesn't matter because they did it, and that is the key that shows us that, yes, indeed, statistically, I saw it with my own eyes, and I see it in other little ways with other little kind of groupings. People who were enemies before join forces and become friends if the greater enemy is the enemy of both. You know what I mean?
Wow.
Well, it's the way of the world. Yep. We're just learning it. I'm not that wise. I'm still, I'm middle age now. But man, I'll tell you, I feel like a kid. I'm such an idiot about so much stuff. So it's just fluoride, man.
I know. Well, guys, check out his movie, Peter Klein. Thank you for being on.
Yeah, well, thank you, Chris. I really appreciate it, and I hope to have some more talks with you again, and stay in touch. Okay.
Yes. Yeah, and hopefully I could get you and Wolfgang, we get all three of us, sure. Hopefully, like in the future.
If you get Wolfgang and want me to join, that'd be totally great. I'd love to do it.
All right. All right. Thank you, Peter.
Thank you, Chris. Bye.
Bye. Wow. Besides the almost 3 hours, it's worth it. We're all over the place, but we want to know the truth. We want to know the real story, what happened. And that's just the best part of all of this, man. And in the end, that is what this is all about, you know. The truth, man. Nothing but indeed.